right, Pat. Legendary Sickos. It's been, I don't know, 6 weeks, 8 weeks. We've only had a couple of in-season. It's about time. I will say, I'm feeling refreshed. I'm excited. The fantasy playoffs are almost here. Playoff best ball has launched. This summer drained me a little bit. And this season, at least the first while, has very much drained me. So, a brief hiatus, but we're back. I'm excited to start to get into, maybe a little bit more of the fun part of the conversation with the best ball playoffs coming around. And we'll save playoff best ball for another day. But with playoff best ball on the horizon, I just want to quickly, I've learned from our hiatus to give our ad read really, really quickly. But playoff best ball, I think you agree with me, is like the literal perfect application of what Pat has built over at Legendary Upside and the tools that we have built at Spike Week. And if you are a Legendary Upside subscriber, you can get 40% off of your Spike Week subscription. You can use the Draft Hacker and Draft IQ and Pat's tools and Pat's rankings and Pat's content and all of that stuff, package it up together. And I genuinely believe like the edge in playoff best ball is massive using all of that, all those tools and content. So 40% off for the leg up people, wanted to make sure to get that in. But non-playoff best ball playoffs coming up here pretty soon. And the beginning of the season, like I mentioned, was a little bit rocky, I think, for most of us. Running backs still keep scoring points and staying healthy, and wide receivers do not. But generally, I feel like it's stabilized a tick outside of, say, a Saquon Barkley. How are you feeling, like, as the season starts to wind down just about, your process, your teams, your portfolio, whatever?
Every season has lessons and, it also has a bunch of variants. So, early on, it's like kind of, I think, especially if you're like, wow, a lot of my takes aren't doing great right now. it can be especially distressing because you're like, which ones are which? And, how do I get better next year? Because we all got to keep getting better. And so this time of year, I find a lot more, it's a lot easier to sift through what's going on, because I think I'm starting to feel like, okay, here were some real misses that I had process wise. I feel like they were misses. Here's some spots where I probably was overconfident given how bad it's gone in the other direction, but I don't really feel like these are like big process misses. Like they, right. I just probably like need to just, as I tell myself every year, try to be a little bit better with building in more nuance. And then there's spots where you're just like, you just ran bad, like Rashee Rice getting hurt was like, Rashee Rice was one of my biggest hits this year. For some people he's not a hit cause he got hurt, and it's like, and in a real, very real sense, he's not a hit cause he got hurt. But like from a process point of view, I'm like, well, there's one that I nailed, I was taking him in the late second round of the big board. Was ahead of him at the very lowest of when he hit that guy, hit the guy, and then I was like, I'm going to take a couple days off. But outside of that, drafted a ton of them. And then he has his quarterback, throw his body through his knee, and that's that. So, I mean, there's some stuff like that where I'm like, I don't know, like, what was I supposed to do? Like I'm of the mind that if you were to put me back in July, I would do that part again with the thinking that like just me being able to do this again is enough variance that Mahomes won't blow out Rice's knee.
That's one of my favorite examples of this. And this is my favorite subject. And I actually think like you said, in terms of improving and always trying to improve our process, analyzing this stuff and figuring out what was a actual process miss, was variance, what was, not necessarily a process miss or hit either way, but you took an, there's risk levels in all this stuff. I'll get to Daniel Jones in a second, but that's one that like, if you came in and you said, just a little too risky for me, right? With A, he's not very good. And B, the contract stuff, you said, I don't want to wade into that. I think that's totally fine process. If you're much like me, I'm willing to wade into those guys a little bit and say, what, they made the playoffs 2 years ago. What if they're competitive? What if they're competitive all the way through the season? And Daniel Jones is pretty solid. Like I'm willing to bet into that. Like I accepted this outcome that we just had for anybody listening to this or recording this on a Monday. Daniel Jones benched, right? Tommy DeVito, which is pretty epic. Nobody was right about this one.
I know, right?
Because everybody said, if I had to hear get ready to learn Drew Locke any more times, I'm like, well, you get ready to learn Tommy DeVito.
Yeah, well, I think Tommy DeVito needs to get ready to learn Drew Locke.
Tommy DeVito needs to get ready to learn. Would you like fries with that? I think pretty soon. The fun fact of here's what we need to apparently do is look into the backup quarterback contracts. I think it's smarter for them to start Tommy DeVito, just like see if he could possibly be the backup next year, because they're not bringing Drew Locke back, and Tommy DeVito will be back. Drew Locke has contract incentives.
No way.
Where if he reaches, I don't have him in front of me, but so some of them were if they make the playoffs and stuff like that, which obviously it's not going to happen. But like, I don't think he's going to hit these, to be clear, because like one of them's completion percentage, not Drew Luck's specialty, but he can make up to like a couple $1 million in incentives if he hits certain milestones or whatever. And I think they were like, well, if we're benching Jones for financial reasons, it's not a lot of money, but there's no real sense in putting Drew Luck out there. So just another weird thing about this season. But separating to the Rashee Rice point, I would lump Chris Godwin into the Rice bucket as well. Like two of the
best. I didn't have a ton of Godwin, but that was a smash. I mean, that was
wide receiver two on the year behind Chase when he got hurt, I believe.
And that, I would say that was a process miss on mine, to not be more open-minded about that flipping again, because it's flipped like so many times about which guy you want. They're both very talented. In retrospect, you're like, oh yeah, it went back to Godwin being the guy, like for the third time.
It's crazy that most things are, everything we'll probably talk about today is never really that simple. But I've always just been a big Chris Godwin fan. Like as a football player, my biggest DFS score was remember Bucks Rams, and there was like 95 points or something like that. And that was back when Goff was there and Jameis was the Bucks quarterback.
Okay,
Godwin was like a true game time decision, and it was an afternoon game. And so nobody played him, and then he was active, and I played him in that game, and he had like 180 yards and two touchdowns in the first half or whatever. Yeah. So it's like the DFS dream, right? Like you can't, he's one, you to Cal and myself are the only two people that played him in one of these higher stakes terms. Naturally you to beat me because Yuta is better than me at DFS. But like, so Chris Godwin has always had a special place in my heart. He's also just a good football player, but moving back into the slot was all the narrative we heard all summer. It was like Godwin is better in the slot. We're going to move him back into the slot in three wide receiver sets or whatever. And it's funny how when you use your players in the ways that they are, you know, best used, and he really popped off. But again, Godwin, Rice, you know, like Tank Dell last year, right? Like some of these guys that are just smashes, and they just get hurt, and maybe they get hurt at the wrong time, and separating out what is all right, or not even just separating out, but being thoughtful about how much of this was variance, how much of this was good process, bad process. And it's like, if you loaded up on Rice and Godwin, you were right. Like you weren't wrong, but you may lose a whole shit ton of money this year, and your process was awesome. I remember lamenting for the first month or 6 weeks or whenever it was until Rice got hurt, being like, I screwed up the Rice thing. You know, I got like 15% of the guy, and I'm like, why didn't I take him every time when he, you're like, I was so stupid. So I actually feel like my process was bad in that I didn't draft more of him, even though my team
would be worse. I drafted a bunch, but still wish I drafted more, even though my teams would be worse. Yeah.
We do now Wednesdays in the Spike Week Discord, we call the lab. It's just like a Zoom call. To actually have like some human interaction, not just all of us sitting on our keyboards. And we just like riff about these kind of subjects that we're talking about here. And that's what, like every week we kind of talk about, like, what do you think you could have done better? Is there any, you know, blah, blah, blah. And like every week, everybody was like, I can't believe I didn't take Rice on every team when he fell to the, you know, seventh round or whatever. And that's everybody. We were like at posing questions and being like, don't, Rashee can't be the answer, right? Okay, who net? It was he was that big of a hit, you know what I mean? And like I said, I think Godwin was in that bucket too. And yet, if you have those guys on teams, you feel really terrible. So it's always funny that we start to, we're soon to be to like Advance Rate Tuesday, where everybody's sharing all their advance rates and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, we all want to advance teams, but you could have a really like poor year and maybe even had one of your best process years, you know, if you had some of these really big hits, but you, it just didn't come together for you.
Yeah, no, it's going to be the case that your best years and your best process years aren't. My best process year, I think, was last year probably, but my best year was the year before, you know, and it's just like, that's the way that goes. I didn't have a particularly good year. The year I won BBM. You know, I had a good a team and that I thought was Liam, like fine make right? the
when Liam won, he had a below average advance rate.
My advance rate was okay that year, but I did. But it was like I think it was in line with expectations, but it wasn't like some of my biggest stands. I was a big Rashad White guy. He was my highest drafted player that year as a rookie. And like some of it didn't pay off as a rookie. It took until the second year. Some of the bigger stands that I had were just, they didn't pan out. And
something with you and Bucks running backs.
I know, seriously. but there were some other, I mean, I think that process wise, maybe that year was okay, but it wasn't like this crazy good year for me. And then, this year, I don't know. I mean, I think there's been some pretty big misses that I've had process wise. I think Kamara really stands out. Like the problem that I see there is I literally did it the year before. And then the lesson I took was let's do this again. One really bothers me.
Why do you think you changed from the year before? And like you said, if you think it's a miss, do you think that that the process that led you to maybe not being in on him despite your prior year, do you think that that's like flawed or you should have just like you said, been a little more nuanced about it? Or what do you think was the big change?
So the year before he was coming off the suspension or he was going to be suspended. And so we had factor in that the suspension cost. So he's not an advanced rate player. And is he a late round? Is he a, you know, late season off a suspension? You know, hammer. And it's like, I don't think so. I mean, you know, he's old. He's really fallen off in the rushing efficiency. But this year was different. This year he had a potential to be what he's going to be, which is a really strong advance rate player. He hadn't fallen off in the receiving last year or the year before. He's been, or this year, you know, he's been really good as a receiver still. His rushing numbers have fallen off, but they haven't continued to get like, you know, worse and worse and worse. They're just bad.
He's not Zeke. Yeah.
He's not Zeke. Yeah. And so you're like, and then we knew there was no competition. You know, I was not drafting Kendre Miller. I never really got on Kendre Miller. I drafted some last year, but I never, you know, this year I was like, they hate him. Like they, you know, it's kind of the being at Roto-World and like, just like following this coach speak stuff. I'm like, they hate this guy's guts. Like he's not a thing.
Can we quickly, Dennis Allen, hating this dude so much that his last act as an NFL football head coach was to put a basically uninjured Kendre Miller on IR, and then he gets fired and all the coaches are like, why is he on IR? Like he could probably practice. And Dennis Allen was, fuck that dude. He's, I don't care what happens to me. I want to make sure that Kendre Miller doesn't play for the next month.
That is downside risk.
That's unbelievable. Sorry, I didn't factor that into my model when I really liked Kendre, that the coach hated him that much. Like, that is some next level hatred, dude. That's some serial killer shit. Like, that's
seriously,
that's insane.
Yeah. And I mean, Jamal Williams was even worse than Kamara in rushing stuff. So I wasn't like, so that's where I'm just like, okay, like, I wanted, you know, okay, but surely he was expensive. He was not expensive. That's where I'm like, all right, man, like, you can spend a seventh round pick on a running back who plays half the season but as a workhorse for half the year. That's worth a seventh round pick, and you know it. So why aren't you doing it? You know, you're like never taking this guy. Like, that's just a process error. I was taking some Aaron Jones. I was taking James Conner. I was doing the other versions of the bet. I just like Kamara, now he stinks, like it's over. I just didn't, that's just like a miss. I don't really, when it hits, you're like, yeah, well, I guess I should have taken him. I don't really have that much, you know, the reasons are that it's not going to happen in some way. You know, you're like, well, when a reality, you know, when we're now living in a reality, and you realize that some of your reasons for that reality not occurring was because it just wasn't going to occur, then it was bad tape. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I like that.
Yeah. So I don't have a lot of reasons for why this is, that this wasn't going to happen now that it's
happened. And that's the important part about all this, I think, that you just nailed, is oftentimes we will latch on to the results of something that happened, right? Team is good. Team is bad. Player is good. Player is bad. Player got benched. Player got hurt, right? We latched. Player got traded. Remember all the Ayuk shit? Like, what a waste of fucking time we had speculating about Brandon Ayuk and the color shorts he wore and was he at the airport and all of this stuff. And not only did he not get traded, he got an extension and then he blew out his knee. So like we're so endlessly wrong, but then the results come in and oftentimes we attach on to the results when most of the time the results are just like, there's a sliding scale, right? There's this range of outcomes. We constantly talk about range of outcomes, median outcomes, right? Ceiling, floor. There's all these different things that can happen, ranging from gets hurt to, you know, is a superstar for most of these players. And then, but it's somewhere in between happens. And then we act as if, you know, it was Thanos. That was inevitable. Once we get the results, we're like, well, yeah, we knew that that guy was going to get benched. We knew that, you know, this guy was going to break out. We knew, and it's like, that's not true. It's really not true. But the process thing can be is when like there was no reasons stopping this like thing from like once you stacked it all up and you said, okay, they hate Kendre Miller, Jamal Williams is worse, Jordan Mims is damn near as old as Alvin Kamara, even though he's a second year player. It's like Dennis Allen's fighting for his life. You know, he failed that fight, but like Dennis Allen, you know, now the new coach is, you know,
new OC with the different system that might boost rushing efficiency potentially, which it honestly didn't really, but like
at first it did for two games.
There were good two games though.
They've had three awesome games. Let me tell you, the two times against the Panthers and against the Cowboys. So if we can get that matchup again, then that'll be great on the ground. But I think that's the important part is I constantly try to tell myself this on not just when it makes me feel better about a miss, but also when like you have a hit, right? Like when I have a bunch of Jordan Mason, which I feel I would do again. Sure. But it was like, you know, it's easy to say, haha, see, I got, you know, Jordan Mason carried my zero RB teams because look, CMC was hurt and I got this awesome first month and a half of the season. It's like, yeah, but like you didn't know that CMC was going to miss. This was a part of the thing. Like CMC's hurt, man. This, you know, you could get something from Mason to start the year and get the contingent value later, but you didn't know that. This is just one way it could have played out. CMC could have played week one. We didn't know, right? They didn't know. The 49ers didn't know that it was this bad. So it can play out in many different. Yeah. It could play out in many. I'm not sure what the hell's going on with with CMC, because now he doesn't look all that good. But maybe he's just
he was fine yesterday. I think he was fine yesterday. Yeah, scoring like we want, but
like I don't want fine against the Seattle Seahawks, dude. Like I want like full play. I played CMC in DFS, in case you can't tell. I want CMC, buddy. But anyway, it's that's what I'm constantly going through right now, right? Is like was it Kamara where I just overlooked him really for like bias reasons and drafted other similar situations, and this outcome, the exact outcome we can argue, right? The like 50 ball against Dallas is fluky and whatnot. Sure. But this run out was probably the most likely because there were no bumps in the road. There was no roadblocks, right? To doing something like this.
I also think like one of the ways to sort of evaluate the process stuff is to look at how guys are getting projected every week.
Yeah.
And Kamara's getting projected super well every week. So you're like, yeah, I mean, here we are. This is the end of the season, right? And Kamara's getting projected super well every single week. And, you know, I couldn't have drafted him in the seventh round or sometimes the eighth round. Like that's a mistake. The other thing about Kamara that I think strengthens the case, you know, for taking him at that price is that he hasn't been efficient as a runner.
Right.
He's ran hot on some touchdown stuff, but he's getting peppered with targets. Sure, he's getting more targets than he would have if Shaheed and Olave were healthy and everything. He's getting, you know, but in some ways he ran bad yesterday with Taysom Hill going nuts.
He'd also score more touchdowns if those guys had access to more touchdowns if the offense wasn't playing Kevin Austin and Mason Tipton and MVS by the way, what the hell is going on?
The GOAT.
This, unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. Taysom Hill and MVS in the same game. Just
that's variance. Thanks for MVS for reminding us that there is just straight up variance in this game.
But, so I do it. Yeah. Sunday, I do a Sunday DFS show, right, for anybody that's listening to this on Rotor Grinders with Neil Orfield, our good friend, Neil. And 2 weeks ago, this is great. This is the epitome of being a tout and having to just eat so many L's along the way is 2 weeks ago, somebody brought up MVS, right? Like, oh, all the Saints wide receivers are out and all this stuff. And we were both like, I'd rather lose than put, you know, however much thousands of dollars, mm-hmm. right? Put a used Kia on MVS in his first game or whatever with the Saints against the Falcons, who's like not that great of a, you know, it's fine. It's not, you know, it's not the Panthers or whatever. And then he scores two touchdowns, right? On three targets, just dunks on that. So we come back this week, we're making fun of ourselves and we're like, okay, but now really like, last week was funny. But now if you play MVS, you're actually an idiot. And then 70.
Yeah.
Amazing.
To go to the other, another big miss for me was Saquon. I don't feel that bad about that, you know, and I'm sorry. Like I'm, you know, if you draft off the rankings, you don't have Saquon, you know, I'm sorry. I don't feel as bad as you want me to feel now, but like I said, here, my take on Saquon was at this price, this guy's he's not going to run hot on touchdowns most likely because he's going to get poached at the goal line. And they just showed with DeAndre Swift, they don't really throw to the running back, even if they've got a pass catching, even a guy who's like kind of his best attribute is that he's a pass catcher. They don't really do that. So you're betting on a breakaway runner, which he, at times he's been a really good breakaway runner, but it's been a few years since we've seen like elite efficiency there. And you're just betting that he's going to like rip off long runs, probably at a career best rate. To make up for the fact that he's like not scoring that many touchdowns around the goal line and not catching that many balls. And that's exactly what's happened. he's been vintage, honestly better than ever. Saquon Barkley, he's playing his career best football, at I believe 26, which is already, you know, that's not what we normally see. It's not possible, of course, but it's not what we normally see. And
27, turns 28.
27. Okay, so even harder. Turns 28 in February. So it's kind of already that's, you know, outlier-ish. But sure, you know, we've seen McCaffrey just have awesome stretches efficiency-wise and, you know, and fantasy impact-wise at that age. So definitely going to happen. And I get why you would have some optimism for it happening, given that, you know, he had the big change in scenery. But like this is the type of outcome when it is priced like it sort of needs to happen that I'm going to bet against. And it was priced that way. You know, maybe on Underdog, some pushback would be like, yeah, but you should have drafted more of him at the 2-3 turn on Underdog. Maybe, you know, on FFPC when he's going at 110, the argument's stronger. And I will concede that he's one of those ones where I would say, I should have built in more nuance, more like, hey, occasionally this guy's going to nuke, try to get some of them just in case you're wrong, because the upside is there. Like, it's not crazy that this guy who was, you know, one of the best running back prospects of all time, had a great rookie season, muddled around in New York for a while, revives his career in Philly. And, you know, that's exactly the way it's played out. But if you make me pay a second round pick for that bet, I'm very unlikely to sign up for it, you know, year over year.
And I understand it's the kind of the same theme that I'll probably just keep reiterating is like, right, there's the scale of all the potential outcomes that can happen from everybody's season. And no one with a brain said, yeah, Saquon's going to be terrible in Philly. Right. It's like, okay, go look at the rankings. Was I lower than ADP on him? Yes. He wasn't ranked 100th. I didn't say like, oh, pff, yeah. LOL, like he's going to be terrible. It's like, no, I'm just very picky about the types of running backs, period. Like I didn't draft Bijan Robinson, dude. And so, like, you know, I didn't draft Breece Hall. Like, now that was a little bit more of an overarching strategy, but I'm personally very, I mean, I'm picky about all early round picks, but especially at running back, especially at a certain age. And when you have, right, you're racking and stacking, like, okay, you mentioned all the pros, but there are also real cons to all this. And it, to the point of, once we get the results, people will forget about the whole picture. You're like, over the summer, we have to talk about the whole picture. We have to talk about our portfolio, right? We have to talk about, we talk about back to front drafting all the time, right? It's like, okay, Saquon in the second seems fine. Like, I think it's fine. But like, also Alvin Kamara that you just talked about was going in the seventh and the eighth. And James Conner was going back there, and Chase Brown feels pretty good to have on teams, right? And I don't know, Brian Robinson and DeAndre Swift is popping back up.
Najee's
like,
been pretty solid.
Najee's been good at, buddy, I never thought that Chuba Hubbard, I'd have to buy a Chuba Hubbard jersey this year, because
well, that's one of the ones I want to talk about, because that was a miss for me and a hit for you.
I didn't draft nearly
enough Hubbard,
and I did not foresee this. Okay, so like to the point of like evaluating process versus results. Like, I clearly feel okay about the Chuba process, but this particular run out is out of control. Like, nobody saw this coming. So anyway, like, everybody forgets that. Right. They're just like, LOL, you didn't draft Saquon, you know? And it's like, yeah, but there was a rhyme or a reason to it. And I understand why someone would. I thought Saquon would have a good year, but there's like tons of outcomes that are like, I don't know, Nico Collins stays healthy. And like, would you rather have Nico Collins with Chuba Hubbard or Saquon Barkley with who the fuck ever went at 145 at wide receiver?
Quentin Johnston?
Like, yeah, like QJ, it's like, okay, that's a hit, I guess. But give me the superstar wide receiver. It's just, I'm constantly trying to because it feels Mooney bad. If you had Mooney, yeah, so it's Saquon Mooney. Yeah. you want that, but like, and I guess that is probably a pretty highly correlated combination. Mooney is an RB Bros wet right. dream, I think. But like, did I
it's the same bet. It's guy changes scenery and he's gonna be good.
Was once
he was last good like 3 years ago, 4 years ago. And so it's the same bet.
Right. So which is makes me feel even dumber, right? It's like my whole thesis was proven completely wrong by two players.
Everyone just change teams and you're good.
Yeah, exactly. But like did anyone foresee Saquon like turning NFL football games into his own version of like NFL Street? Like, the dude's jumping and hurtling backwards. Like, it's sick, man. And like,
I do enjoy it.
Like, hat tip. Yeah. He's fun to watch. He's really good. And he keeps breaking these runs. Do I feel bad? Right. Like, process wise, like I said, around the edges, we could argue about like you said, at the 2-3 turn, should I sprinkle them in a little bit as opposed to taking neighbors every time?
Yeah, yeah,
it's like, okay, we can have that conversation. But do I feel bad about like where I ranked him? Like, kind of not really. And I'm sorry if like that makes people.
It's trigger. A little low. I got there with Jonathan Taylor. I eventually was like, well, I can see it's a limited profile. He doesn't really have legendary upside, but I could see in best ball how he pays off. He's younger. It basically just came down to, he's a lot younger, and so I can see him recapturing.
Might be better, yeah.
Or he might be better.
It's an easier bet. It's a clearer bet to make that he's better than Saquon at this point.
Yes, yeah. At this point in their careers, but I should have taken that same, you know, open mindedness to the upside with Saquon. I think I was a little too certain at the upside, because that's the type we're trying to factor in the most likely outcomes, the floor outcomes and the upside outcomes. And I'm just going to, that'll be a focus in general of mine to try to do a better job of that next year with the rankings and everything. Because I think with Saquon, I probably was too close-minded to the upside, even though I think I was like pretty dead on with like what needed to happen. Mm-hmm. You know, I I don't really see much chance of that happening. That's the part where I should have been more open-minded to him actually achieving the difficult set of circumstances that I thought was in front of him to become this, you know.
Do you think your assessment of the probability of this happening was wrong, or do you just think that we thought this is, you know, a really really low probability outcome, and it's a low probability outcome, but maybe not so drastic as we probably talked about.
I think I've set the probability of him being good enough to thread this needle too low. Because he's been like so good, you know, he's been so consistently good. He was a great running back prospect. He already had a legendary season. He had a really good, kind of volume driven season 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. That was really strong, but you know,
didn't he catch 100 balls 2 years ago?
Did he?
Cause that was the
shitload of balls his rookie year.
That was the Richie James, Isaiah Hodgins, Giants team.
Right. And then we drafted Richie James on the Chiefs the following year.
Yeah. That's sweet.
No, in 2022, he only caught 57. He had 91 receptions as a rookie on 121 targets. Yeah. But he ran for 10 touchdowns and 1,300 yards. He actually ran for the most yards of his career in 2022 with 4.4 yards per carry, down from 5 in his rookie season. But it was a kind of recapturing of like it wasn't the smash that his rookie season was. Points per game, PPR, he was 24 as a rookie. In 2022, he's only 17.6. But it's a pretty good season, you know. And so it's like, part of my argument against him is like, we haven't seen, you know, the legendary upside since his rookie season. But he, as a sophomore, he was at 18.8 points per game. And then in 2022, he was at 17.6. Fell down to 15.9 in 2023, which isn't a disaster. But it's like, you know, you're kind of like, yeah, you know, this guy's 27 now. What are the chances he recaptures this? And I think, given the prospect that he was and a history in the league of really tremendous production when things were working in his favor. And then we'd also seen, you know, if I'm going to go back and talk some sense in myself, I'd be like, Christian McCaffrey didn't have very good efficiency for a while there either, remember? Until he goes to the 49ers. And
Niners. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And in some ways, I wonder how much our opinion of him, it was easy because he missed so many of those seasons due to injury. So he didn't chalk up bad numbers for us to go, he's washed. But he probably would have looked pretty washed on those teams. And so, you know, and by the way, these were arguments people were making at the time when drafting Saquon. Is like, he only looked washed because he was next to Daniel Jones. He's on these Giants.
Right. Things. Right.
Washed now. So, you know, the Saquon drafters saw this in real time and were yelling at me about it. And I was like, no, you're wrong. You know, so that's where I think there's lots of evidence that I set the probability of the upside too low, I think.
The only thing that keeps me coming back to like, I think I'm willing to capitulate to what you just said, that just the probability that he's just still,
I think awesome. The median was good. Yeah, by the way, I was in line with like projections on him too.
Yes,
you know,
right.
So I think the median I do feel good about. But probably going to mostly bet against prospects, their profiles like this going forward, but maybe a little less confident.
All I think he's really made me do is, again, like just be a little more thoughtful and think about these things a little bit. I also think this is a really unique situation. Not to turn this into a whole Saquon thing, but I think that all the nuance around him is pretty fascinating. And again, as is, you know, the best ball bubble in really modern society. We don't care to have any real actual discussion and nuanced discourse about things. It is LOL, you dumbass, you zero RB bro, you didn't draft Saquon. Ha ha, you suck, right? But if you recall, that part of my take around Saquon and the Eagles, because I did not draft very much Jalen Hurts. I was higher on, this doesn't look good, by the way, I was higher on Garrett Wilson than A.J. Brown. I drafted A.J. Brown. But I mean, it's hard to fade early wide receivers when you're drafting all zero running back teams. I don't try to do that. But if you recall last year, the stretch run for the Eagles offense was fucking awful. Yeah. They were horrendous on offense. So you add in all the things you talked about, Saquon's profile himself. You add in this like layer of risk that the market just said, those final 7-8 weeks, we don't get. Who cares? It's the Eagles, dude. It's the Eagles. Didn't you see what they did? You know, look how good they were in the Super Bowl, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, well, and that's kind of a big part of my process is trying to find the stuff that may not even impact the median I never really know exactly how much it's going to impact, right, the range of outcomes or whatever, but there's this thing that the market is just saying, we don't care that they suck down the stretch. We don't care that they're always going to tush push at the one, right? It was actually more people saying, well, you know, Jason Kelsey's gone. Are they really going to keep
tush pushing? Right.
It was that was an argument for Saquon, was like, well, Jason Kelsey's gone. So are they going to keep doing the tush push? Spoiler, yes, it's a Jalen Hurts.
Obviously they are. Yeah, Jalen Hurts. It helps when your quarterback squats an insane amount.
Fucking strongest legs in the NFL. Like, it's a Jalen Hurts thing. Yeah. Now that, like, look at Josh Allen is not a good QB sneaker, even though he's an awesome running quarterback. It's Jalen Hurts' leg strength.
That's where I would be like, okay, I got this wrong. Like, clearly I was wrong about the tush push stuff. Like, they throw to him. Like, dude, they're throwing to him nonstop. Like, nope, they're not throwing to him at all. You know, not. But like, and for some reason, you know, especially early on, they were all going for touchdowns. He's only actually caught two touchdowns. If you ask me how many touchdowns Saquon's caught, I'd be like seven. That's how it feels. It's actually two. He's got, let's see, he's got 23 receptions per game. The cutoff that I use for, it's like a, you know, it's just like to help dial in these profiles. But it's nice if a running back has a path to 4+ receptions per game. He's at 2.3. So that doesn't mean he's dead, obviously, to get to a legendary season. Although, to be fair, he's still below what that mark was. Now, this is for more, frankly, a higher scoring season than the one we've had. And also more of a redraft idea than purely a best ball idea. But for as good a season as he's had, he's still actually not at the 23 points per game threshold. He's at 21.7, and he very well could get to the 23. And for all intents and purposes, it doesn't matter. He's having a legendary season in terms of what he's doing for your teams relative to your opponent's teams. So it's kind of irrelevant anyway. But just to the point of like me trying to dial in what was going to happen here, I'm like, if I'm going to take a running back who's going to nuke in the early rounds, I want access to receptions. That's probably the biggest thing. Do I have access to receptions? Like, I don't feel confident in that. I really think that, like, given what we saw with Swift, you're not going to see the receptions be even close maybe to the rate that we want. Do I have access to touchdowns? Some, right? But maybe not like a 20 touchdown season.
The move to the Eagles gave him access to more touchdowns than he previously had and more touchdowns than most running backs, but that was priced in. He doesn't necessarily have access to like this legendary amount of touchdowns because so many get siphoned and people are like, oh, he gets unlucky sometimes as the one. Like, there's a certain set amount of times players go down at the one. Like, it's not like every time is unlucky for the running back. It's like, no, you're gonna go down at the one. Like if it would be lucky to never have to never
right. It'd be very lucky
over the course of the season. So he's also running hot on long touchdowns. Okay, he loses a couple from the one. I've heard that argument too. Like, he's actually running bad. I'm like, I think that's a little disingenuous. I think he's running pretty good, maybe not perfect. Right. But it's not like a case of, oh, you should really be getting dunked on by Saquon. Look at all the Hurts touchdowns. It's like, part of that's expected. Right. So like, some of that is expected. We can argue about the specifics.
Yeah, exactly. And so he's got 8 rushing touchdowns this year, which is, you know, good. Like, but it's not generally with what you see is like, if the guys don't have access to 4+ receptions per game, but they're still gonna have these incredible seasons, they normally score like 20 touchdowns. And
Derrick Henry.
Yeah, Derrick Henry.
He just goes nuts. Yeah.
He just goes nuts. He runs for 20 touchdowns. I didn't think there was that high of a chance of him doing that. So it's like, well, then the third path would be what we're actually seeing, which is like, he's not going to catch that many passes. He's not going to score that many touchdowns, score a good amount of touchdowns. And he's going to get there with like 5.8 yards per carry on, you know, almost 200 carries through the first 10 games of the year. He's 197 carries. He's averaging 19.7 carries per game.
It's nuts.
That's old school stuff that like has not been. Now, maybe, you know, as we move forward, we need to be thinking that the league might be moving back towards that style in some ways. And we're seeing, you know, the Lions and the Eagles, some of these good teams are really leaning on the run, and it's effective. And, you know, of the too high discourse and all of that. Like, maybe this type of profile is making a little bit of a comeback. It's still not as powerful as it once was. I mean, back in the day, like, we're talking about a guy, you know, let's pull up Priest Holmes's, like, 2000, what was Priest Holmes 2001? What did that look like? Priest Holmes. Like, no, I guess that wasn't his nuts season. When did he go absolutely nuclear?
Or like
Oh, it was 2002. 2002, Priest Holmes. Oh, no, 2003 was the touchdown season. 2003, he had 1,420 yards, 27 rushing touchdowns. Then he added 74 receptions for 690 yards. That was pretty good.
Future Chief running back.
Larry Johnson?
Larry Johnson, a couple of years there later. So 336 yards for 1,750 touchdowns. Saquon and Derrick Henry make me feel like people are scoring 1,750 touchdowns. 1,750 yards, 20 touchdowns with 33 receptions for another touchdown. The next season, at age 27, 416 carries for Larry Johnson. You're talking about Saquon in 10 games having 197, and that's a huge number. Fucker had 416 in 16 games. They only played 16 games.
Yeah.
That's just absolute lunacy. So
how about Sean Alexander? 370 carries, 1,880 rushing yards, 5.1 yards per carry, 27 rushing touchdowns, 15 receptions, 78 yards, and a touchdown. Just pure rushing. Just absolutely smashes. 23.6 PPR points per game. Barely caught any passes.
Sean Alexander was on the cover of Madden after that season. We haven't had a running back. It's all quarterbacks and wide receivers now. We're about to make a shift. Saquon
is going
to be the Madden cover next year, I think, is what we're learning. Just another thing on the Eagles. We had a fun chat in the Discord about the Eagles. And I caught – so it's basketball season, right? I'm a big basketball fan. And there's a fun little like kind of bit that goes around a little more in the college basketball circles because – it's a little more fun, but they, you know, people like classify, especially basketball players, into like archetypes, right? You kind of have like pass first point guard, then you have like the scoring, you know, the scoring guys, they constantly call like 3-and-D players, right? Like 3-and-D wings is a big deal, traditional centers. Well, like shooter, like, can you shoot, right? Like shooting is so big and spacing the floor in basketball. So you talk about like shooters who actually can't shoot. Is like teams deploy them as like, this is our 3-point shooter, but he shoots 28% from the 3-point line or whatever. The Eagles to me are like the shooter who can't shoot. They're the elite offense. That's like, not really that like
they score too much running through Saquon. That's why you feel that way. Cause you don't have Saquon.
I know, because I do have some AJ Brown. And I have a bunch of Devonta Smith and I'm just like, you watch every game and it's like, They only attempt like 20 passes. Five of those are Jalen Hurts throwaways because he throws the ball away at an absurd clip because he won't ever force a ball into a tight window, right? And then he scrambles another five times a game. So they call 25, 30 dropbacks and you only get 20 actual pass attempts. And then even setting aside like that, just like raw number, in the second half, their defense has been really good. Again this year, and when the defense is playing well, Sirianni has no interest in putting the ball in the air in the second half. It is all run. I don't care if it's Gainwell or Shipley, they're running it. Like they have no interest in taking to the air, despite the fact that they have AJ Brown and Devonta Smith and Dallas Goedert. And so it's this. I know that they're scoring points. I don't actually mean that they're not good, but just like fundamentally, the way that they play offense is kind of like the right like. You're not watching the Ravens and Lamar's just fucking all over the place. And Derrick Henry rips off a 70-yard touchdown. I know Saquon's doing that too. But then Zay catches a bomb, right? Tylan Wallace tightropes the sideline. It's like they're fun. It looks like an awesome offense. Whereas the Eagles are like, damn, they scored 28. You're like, Jalen Hurts threw 14 passes. Like, what is this, fucking Army Navy? Like what is going on
here? No, I mean – yeah, I have this chart that I share in the walkthrough every week that's it's split into four quadrants, and the bottom left hand is teams that have a low expected pass rate and then a low pass rate. So, you know, they're dictating the run, kind of your classic, but there's levels to that type of style. And the Eagles and Lions and we have an Arthur Smith offense on a team that is winning a lot of games. And Arthur Smith is third. The classic, which teams are truly dictating the run this season? It's the Eagles and Lions kind of in their own tier. And then you'd say the Steelers and then the Chargers. And then kind of a gap because you get like teams like the Ravens aren't like necessarily always winning. Right. So they're not always dictating the run, but they certainly do run from ahead.
And they're never winning against Jamar Chase because they just don't cover the motherfucker every time that they play each other. He drops, he goes for 250 yards.
But I have to say, I mean, I do on some stuff with Saquon, like it's I'm getting the worst of it on all of it, right? Like it's except the, you know, the tush push stuff. But again, I think that was very predictable. But like the entire offense is built around him.
Yeah,
his efficiency is career best. I mean, and he's having an incredible season, but he's still the point output is still a little lower than
look at you last know, week. Dude, look at last week. He was having it was fine. You know, he's going to have 130 yards or whatever on the day, which is obviously a good game, but nothing groundbreaking. And then in the final 3 minutes, he rips off two long fluky touchdown runs, and he's really good, so he's going to do it more. You know, I get. All of the
and honestly for caveats. Best ball, I mean, he's a veteran best ball running back, you know, so he's had lows of 7.4, you know, we're mostly talking underdog for best ball, but I think more in PPR. So 7.4 PPR points and 8.8 in week 10 against the Cowboys, hilariously. But then he goes off for 33 points in week 1, 34 points in week 9, 34 points last week. So he's got these mass, not just like he's hitting 25. He also got a 26.7 in there against the Giants. But like he's hitting these huge games where all of them hit your lineup at once. It's beautiful. So that's another part of it where, like, again, I do think I missed on kind of the probability of him hitting. And then maybe that probability when he does hit that, how impactful that could be as part of, you know, like a hero running back build. So you have Saquon just coming in and like, here's 35. So, but you know, we're going to be wrong about stuff. And I think a lot of it is like, you're trying to position yourself so that like when you're wrong, a lot of things needed to happen for you to be really wrong. And when you're right, like not that many things needed to happen for you to be right. And that's where stuff like, I wish I had more Godwin because like that was a really simple upside case that like in retrospect is extremely obvious, you know? I wish I had more Chuba because I was thinking through Chuba. Like Chuba, I was kind of more on the side of like the draft. Okay, I don't really want to be invested in the Panthers anyway.
You're right.
Yeah. You know, and so then they just drafted this guy that I'm excited about in the second round. And so like, you know, yeah, you're going to get some Chuba in the beginning of the year, but like for how long? And then, you know, how valuable is that production ultimately even going to be? And then it's going to go away. And so it's kind of like this helpful pick, but it's not going to be like a big win. On the flip side though, Chuba's good. I had a bunch of Chuba the year before. I believe her in his talent. The guy they drafted had an ACL tear the year before and is
in November.
So like it might take him longer. You know, it's just total shock that he hasn't really done anything yet. Like, no. Even though I drafted a bunch of Jonathan Brooks, but he's finally going to play,
by the way, this week. Finally. It only took 11 weeks, but we're finally going to get confirmed. We're finally going to get confirmed it today.
Yeah. And then, like, he was so cheap that if you get – so an upside – what does an upside scenario look like? Like, we're living in it. You know, like, this is already upside. Like, I don't need him to – you know, compared to, like, a guy like Daniel Jones. Like, I didn't take any Daniel Jones. Not any. I would sometimes use him as a bailout quarterback. Mm-hmm. So I didn't have to take like Fields or not Fields. I actually drafted a decent amount of Fields. So I didn't have to take Russ. I didn't take as much Fields as I actually wanted to at the time because I was drafting so much May.
Yeah. But there's another guy. If we, it's like the Saints. If we'd had this conversation, you know, after the Colts game for Justin Fields, you're like, these idiots didn't draft Justin Fields.
Why didn't I draft more Justin Fields? I was like, oh, I drafted way too much May, not enough Fields. I should have split that more.
And now you're like, thank God.
Thank God. Thank God. But yeah, like with Daniel Jones, I think that at the onesie positions, I still think, like, you know, we had the Howell debate last year. Jones, I think, was a, you know, similar setup to that, where I'm like, I'm worried I'm going to lose him at the end of the year when it matters the most. And like, if I have to take a third quarterback to like cover that, then that's not an ideal use of resources. But if I'm taking another running back to like help layer in late season production for Chuba, like if Chuba plus, you know, if Chuba plus Chase Brown is like a smash, like, is that's so worth the price that you paid for that? Like, that's just like such an obvious, like, that combo. I drafted a decent amount of Brown. I wasn't as high on Brown as like Gretch and some of the other guys and Siegel and stuff, but I did. It's one of those ones where I was like, I'm not missing the boat. You know, I know Davis got way more.
And the upside case, like, is really clear. Even if
upside case is clear.
It's okay to be able to say there are some flaws here. Everybody's very excited, but let's like,
right. That's kind of where I was. Let's like wait a little temper a little.
He's not prime Marshall Faulk. Okay. Like that's how it felt that everybody felt about Chase Brown.
It's yeah.
Like he is literally going to set the world. He is shot out of a cannon, as someone famously mentioned the other day. Everybody was so sure that Chase Brown was going to happen. And you know, maybe they were right. It is what it is. But I think it was fair to just say, can we at least like talk about some of the flaws? We're all so infatuated with the guy.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but like if I'm taking, and I take these profiles all the time, you know, I take them at, I mean, frankly, I should have more Brooks and Chuba, you know, because their outcomes were correlated in a way of like, you're betting on the Panthers to be good enough to support a running back. So there, that one really bugs me. That's a Kamara level. It bugs me because I never thought Chuba could like be this. I did. I literally had bet on it. He was one of my hits from the year before. I was just like, too excited about a different player. It was very different from Kamara in that way, because I'm like, I know I want to bet on this guy instead. But I don't know why I didn't. And I've done this at times, you know. I did this with Rojo and Fournette. The 1 year it worked, and then the next year it didn't work at all. But like, why can't I split that a little bit more and go, yeah, I'm going to bet. Because the prices put you in a position where you could split it. And I did a decent job of that in other spots. You know, I didn't have any problem taking Braylon Allen. I didn't have any problem taking Tyler Algier, even though I was drafting Brees and Bijan, but I was drafting their guys too. So yeah, the Chuba one just definitely busts me. Like, he rated well in my stuff. I just pulled up the, you know, his efficiency and everything. I'm like, yeah, he rates as like a clear target in the late rounds, So I would say those are the two that probably like bug me the most, of like, just go back and like think through things, maybe like have a different first day that you're like thinking through, you know, if you sat down, like I would like to like sit down and like start the process again and like see if maybe I just would have been like higher on Chuba that day, you know. It's like, it's, yeah. You know, because I'm like, you kind of liked him if you thought about it a little bit more.
I think we all run into every year we have some of those, right? Like you said, Kamara and some of these where we're like, I'm doing this with a different guy. Like I'm, you know, like I really liked James Conner, happy. I'm really, really happy about the James Conner that I have, but I just like wasn't drafting Kamara. And it was like I mean, I know that there's differences around the edges, but overall it's really kind of the same bet at a high level. And I think I would say a couple things on Chuba. One, structurally, like this is a much more fun conversation for me than Saquon, because it's actually someone.
Because you're right.
Actually a good player that I drafted. There's not very good and healthy and on my teams.
Yeah.
It's rare, it's nice. And it keeps getting worse. It keeps getting worse as the season keeps going on. When Ladd went down last night, I was just like, just shut it all down. I'm so done.
Ladd's good. It's nice that Ladd is good. He's fun.
T and Ladd, you know, T took that rib shot or back shot and Ladd took the shoulder, and I was just like,
how about the Puka? When Puka knocked the wind out of him,
landed on the ball. I thought it was shoulder. I thought it was his shoulder when he would look like he was on his shoulder at first, and I'm just like, he's a smash, right? And Puka looks like
Puka was one of the best picks of the year. I'm sorry. Now the knee thing, I guess we should have factored in more, but like, God, that guy's good.
Yeah, he's so good. And Stafford is as good as ever, man. Goddamn. And McVay's a wizard. But So with Chuba, you kind of outlined a lot of it, but where I think this is probably the thing I did the best. Well, like Chuba is probably the best pick I made all year, but also like you said, I really like Jonathan Brooks. I was excited for Jonathan Brooks. I also was not really excited for Carolina, but I was actually willing to, and like I did this with Najee and Jalen Warren. I did this with Zach Moss and Chase Brown. And so sometimes you pay a tax, right? Zach Moss, we talk about that, right? Like Zach Moss was the tax I had to pay to get Chase Brown, to get some more Najee and to get more Chuba. Was just like, again, like take a step back and say, like, don't be so obsessed with your individual player take between, you know, a Jonathan Brooks and a Chuba. And then in this specific, which is more of a Najee Warren or a Moss Chase Brown type conversation. But with Chuba, it wasn't that, because I really like Chuba as a player, just like you, dating back to, dude, if he would have come out after his junior year of college, I don't know, everybody should go look at Chuba Hubbard's junior year of college at Oklahoma State. He would have been like the RB. I don't remember who's in that class. He set the world on fire, dude. He was absolutely unbelievable. Comes back for his senior year, gets banged up. He's like playing on a bum ankle all year, was down efficiency. So he fell to what, the fourth round, I believe.
I think he fell to the fourth round, yeah. And had a horrible rookie season in terms of efficiency as well.
But then they trade CMC, and it's him and Foreman, right? Him and Foreman.
Yeah.
Both kind of a tandem being pretty good.
Foreman was kind of better. Yeah, but it was close. Yeah.
Yeah. They're, you know, this two-headed monster that was, they were running efficiently on the Panthers with, I think Darnold came back and was the quarterback down the stretch.
Yeah, that's right. They shuffled through. They like brought him back. Yeah.
Kyle Allen started games and like, yeah, it was bad. Yeah. So anyway, my assessment was that Chuba is a good NFL running back.
And that's when I got on board too. I was like, he was actually pretty good.
Yeah.
So
then, I think the drafting of Brooks was like all right, Miles Sanders is going out to pasture, right? Was kind of my assessment of that. And then, like you said, when I'm thinking through structurally, I got a little bailed out by the way that I draft, in that I'm like, okay, I actually sat and thought about this, as opposed to a lot of things that I don't necessarily break down. To me, the early season bets used to be the guys where I would, you know, I always call it the Samaje Perine on the Denver Broncos, right? The like this dusty veteran that you don't actually really want on your teams, but you can talk yourself into on like a zero or a hero running back team, because you're like, well, Javonte will come along slow that year. And it's like, we're really so bad at predicting that, specifically for bad players, right?
Yeah, that's a great point.
I don't want to call Perine bad, because he has,
but Zeke, like Zeke, you know, was supposed to be that this year, and he just sucked.
Zeke was he's gonna, you know, Dowdle will take over, but Zeke's gonna, right, you know, score some touchdowns to start the year and help you out or whatever, which is bullshit. We're just not that good at predicting it for the players who are not very good. But I was like, well, but I think Chuba is good, right? And I'm like, I don't know that Brooks is gonna be ready. And like the Panthers thing was like, wait a second, if you don't really like them, why would they rush Jonathan Brooks back, right? It was like kind of all these different things coming together where I was just like, okay, so what's the worst case? I need an early running back for, like, I got 60% Tyler Algier, buddy. He's not gonna do anything for a long time, you know. Like, I didn't know Jordan Mason was gonna be starting week one at the at this time. I have a ton of Braylon. I'm like, I have a lot of guys. So I actually did the thing where it was like the early season production would be really nice, but also those guys, when they're talented, can also then turn early season production into maybe middling production when Brooks comes back, but then still have contingent value again, right? It's kind of like, I would rather have the contingent, you know, I would rather just have the guy come through, you know, like a Rashad Penny did the year he, you know, went scorched earth down the stretch in the playoffs, of course, but it's not useless if I'm getting that early season stuff. And then who knows, maybe I get another game or two. Right, like Jordan Mason has buoyed my advance rate, keeps going down. But if I didn't draft Jordan Mason, dude, my teams would be fucking horrible, like horrible, because I needed that. And so you're kind of hoping that these guys can pass the baton, right? Jordan Mason,
right, 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 right.
And then
which is a concept I really buy into at running back. So that's where
there is no next guy. Like I only have a two-man relay, right? We forgot the third and the fourth leg of my relay. They're waiting for somebody to catch the baton.
Right.
And they're not there, but that's the hope, right? Is that Chuba and Mason and whoever, like, come on, you know, maybe it is Connor, maybe it is Kamara, maybe it is, you know, Swift or whatever. And then your Braylons or your Bijans or Algiers or whoever, they take the baton for the playoffs, right? Or just a week. Like, do one.
You know what's funny too is that there's someone in the pool that doesn't feel like a hit at all right now that is going to be who you're talking about. Mm-hmm. That is like the point of having a Mason and a Chuba and some of these, you know, these guys whose production has already peaked or is maybe basically done. Is going to hand it off. We don't know to who yet. It could be Trey Benson,
right?
You know, it could be Corum, right? It could be Braylon Allen. It could be there's a bunch of these guys who have shown that they're actually kind of interesting, but probably won't get enough work. But like, you know, contingent value, they could.
It's a little bit of Tyrone Tracy. It's a little bit of I didn't draft much Tyrone Tracy. So that's a whiff by me that I. That's one I feel bad, but to what degree I'm not entirely sure. Like I buy into, and clearly I mean he's good. Tyrone Tracy's good.
He's good. Right?
I'm not questioning whether or not he's good now, but also like a old ass prospect who played wide receiver for most of his career and then was like basically a backup. Even when he converted to running back, he was behind a former walk-on at Purdue, and I was just like, I get it, but I'm like, is he ever going to be the man? Which was like my concern. I capitulated more on Bucky, but it was like my Bucky concern too. I'm like, I'm double the field on Bucky or something like that. But I was like, when I win, I want to fucking win. Like I want to win, you know? And so like converted wide receivers, it was like hard for me to say like Braylon Allen or Tyrone Tracy. And I'm like, I can see the win, you know, with Braylon Allen.
Tracy didn't need the contingent is why he could have the guy sprain his ankle or whatever Singletary did. And then he can take the job.
Singletary missed one game and it was over.
It was over. Right?
It was over. So
Allen doesn't have that.
I
actually drafted more Tracy. That was at least a hit for me, but not a huge one. Not one that I like made the season about, but that was, yeah, Tracy.
But he would be a great
Tracy's
one,
been
right?
Helpful.
If you have Mason,
yeah,
and
he's been a great.
You have Tracy. It's like that's the perfect handoff type.
That's a handoff situation for sure. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that's in a way maybe Daniel Jones was your tax for Chuba because you're like you know more than me, just like, hey, I'm gonna take the bird in the hand on some of this production, which I feel like I didn't. Like, you know, specifically with Chuba, I just should have done a better job and a little bit more with Jordan Mason because you're taking the bird in the hand at the beginning of the season. I might get some games in the beginning and then I'll have the contingent value the rest of the way.
And it's the fucking 49ers.
And it's the 49ers. Yeah.
Which isn't as good as we thought. At the beginning of the year, it felt awesome. It doesn't
feel funny so that good. That's not as, yeah. Yeah. But yeah, I'm like much more, you know, but maybe, you know, hopefully we'll see how it goes. But hopefully Jonathan Brooks is the tax I paid for Drake May, because the Drake May stuff is starting to look fun. Now, Jalen Polk being tied to him is no fun, but Demaryius Douglas, Hunter Henry, that one's, but I, you know, it's also tough now as well, because like there's some of my bigger stands, you know, Jalen Warren has been, you know, dealing with injuries all year, has not looked as good as I was hoping when he's been out there, but he's had flashes and then, you know, he flashes and then he goes on the injury report with a back injury thinking now he can play. I do that one. I've been thinking about the Warren one because I'm like, I do wonder if, like, so he was priced pretty well relative to similar bets in the past. I wrote this up in the offseason. You look at like Tony Pollard and Ramondre Stevenson, some of these guys are like, well, he's not the guy and he's not gonna be the guy. So what's the point? And it's like, well, but what if he becomes the guy? Like, he could absolutely smash. And relative to those players, like, he was priced pretty well. But those players were in running back landscapes where you just didn't have as many like touches available. So relative to the amount of touches that you could find elsewhere in the player pool, he was not priced all that well. The tricky part for me is that it's been like the worst possible run out for Warren. Like he starts the year hurt. He's like playing through an injury and not playing well. They shut him down because it's that bad. He comes back. He looks much better. And then he has like a back injury thing. I guess he was fine last week, but like he needed to take away a job, right? The status quo is not helpful to him. He needs to be good enough to take another guy's job away. He'd been so good that I'm like, and Najee has not been that good. He hasn't been terrible. He was a star of his career. He was okay last year. He's been okay this year. But I'm like, he's going to have a real chance here to be the lead back and run heavy offense, and he catches passes. So that's like a potential huge hit that we're getting for the price. But, you know, even if he hit what I think he could have hit, now having seen this season play out, I'm like, he's not that big of a hit relative to we've gotten from Kamara, Connor, Swift. Like, all these hits have actually been pretty damn good. And the upside case for Warren was not, like, it felt good for the price to me, but it feels worse to, you know, for the price now, even though it didn't happen. And I think personally that it not happening this clearly is like kind of bad luck, you know, but you know, your opinions may vary there. But I do think, like, I'm constantly trying to like dial in what kind of each pick is worth, or like what we're asking for from a given selection. And I do think if running back pricing, now maybe running back pricing just moves up next year, and I'm sitting in the Warren range going, a Warren type bet at this price? Hell yeah.
Yeah.
But if running back pricing is similar to last year again in 2025, then I think I need more touches at the price that Warren required. Then again, Zach Moss or Chase Brown he wasn't too far behind Warren. He's been you know, you would do anything to have Chase Brown on some of these teams that are advancing at this point. So yep. I don't want to like overly, he's a really tricky one for me. Cause I'm like, I think largely it's just like talented secondary running back who needed to change the status quo environment, struggles through injuries all year, wasn't able to change the environment. The status quo does not help us. We need him to do the Chase Brown thing where it's like, no, I'm the lead back. Put me in and treat me like the lead back. And it finally happens. And then you're like, I want him on every team. That outcome is not very, I mean, I guess it's possible that we get it at the very end of the season, but like on what teams, you know, Warren's going to be a real, really hurts your advance rates because there were guys in that range that are going to be advance rate monsters that you passed on instead. And, you know, in zero running back rooms, you're struggling to not have too thin of a room to begin with. And he's a part of thin rooms now. Although to be honest, I am going to advance some Warren teams in part because of Warren points.
I got teams that could use that fucker's 6 points a game.
Yeah, exactly. Right, exactly. So it's not even completely dead yet. We'll see. But, you know, it's clearly it's not one I'm enjoying. Yeah. Put it that way.
I've been thinking about that range as well, because I think we talked a lot about it over the summer, but it's sometimes you kind of need to see it play out for it really to settle in. And like you said, even setting aside Kamara, but like the James Conners and DeAndre Swifts that are there, that we knew, I don't want to overstate the Swift thing. I think we were pretty confident he'd get the first crack. Exactly how that one was going to shake out in terms of them literally,
I'm okay with the Swift fade, to be honest,
them hating Khalil Herbert so much that they trade him and make him game day inactives was a unique run out, I think. Shout out to Travis Homer, who apparently is like, he got shit on every coach that he's ever played for, because like they don't play him, but he banishes good players to the sideline.
He's a Dare Gumbawala.
Yeah, he is. He's Dare, because Rashad Penny was once upon a time inactive for Homer in Homer and DJ Dallas.
Mm-hmm. DJ Dallas is another Dare. They had two Dares on that team.
God.
DJ Dallas still on Arizona? Because Amari DiMercado makes me feel
like, no,
Arizona's just loading up with all of these vagabond running backs who keep jobs and whatever. So yeah, Khalil Herbert maybe is just a bad guy, or we're just not right about his talent or whatever. But anyway, I don't want to overdo the Swift thing. I don't feel I'm not like I drafted Swift because, again, part of what I'm the tax thing is like important to me, is a big part of what like my strategy was this year. Like you said, I was willing to pay taxes on Daniel Jones or Zach Moss or frankly, Zamir White. Like these are guys who were not my favorite picks. So I wasn't going to draft them at a higher clip than James Conner and then Jaylen Warren and Chase Brown, whatever. But I was in years past, I would take my structural stand and then make a whole bunch more stands within structure.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And when it hits, sure, great. But it feels like an unnecessary risk. You guys talked on ADP chasing earlier today about some playoff best ball. And it was hitting home with me for regular best ball in terms of my strategy as well, where like I'm willing to pay those taxes because I don't need to hit this crazy long shot parlay to beat my opponents in this particular game. If my structure is right with zero running back and I'm going to draft 1500 teams or whatever, just like let that win it for you. You know, you can take the guys that you want a little bit more, right? Like you like the Lions more than you like whatever other team for playoff best ball. It's like, yeah, but you don't got to do the Cardinals. You know, like you don't got to do like the Niners are like 20% to make the playoffs now, which sounds crazy, but like you don't got to like shove all your chips in on the Niners. It's like, okay, maybe a sprinkle or whatever, and you know, is fine, but you don't have to go so crazy to say like, I'm going to take this mega long shot parlay. And I think that was something that I did well, but then going back and analyzing to like the Jaylen Warren thing is like, could I have done things a little differently within those buckets? Like I was never gonna, you know, like certainly not fade Jaylen Warren or anything like that, but I liked him a lot as well. And how much should we prioritize the guys who out of the gate, their path is they need to play well, right? DeAndre Swift just needs to play well. He doesn't need something to change, which I guess him playing well could be a change. He just needs to go out and do something with his touches that we know he's going to get. Jaylen Warren needs something truly to change because they're not going to stop playing Najee unless something specifically changes. Like Warren just goes out and is absolutely incredible on 8 touches. It's like even then Najee's going to play. We need an injury or something chaotic to happen to help him. So how do we value those two? Because we know that Warren can be a league winner if that chaos hits him, but I know that he needs it, whereas Swift just needs to go out and play well, and like he's much more useful. Is he a league winner? I don't know. But, you know, like that balancing act of the chaos part versus the like seizure opportunity that's guaranteed, I still don't really know how to price that.
Yeah, and I mean, Swift is like one of those dudes where I'm okay – Swift to me is like a tax. Not drafting a ton of Swift is like a tax that I feel like I paid to like avoid, you know, Alexander Mattison and Miles Sanders. Yeah. And like those, like to me, he was very much like in that bucket of guy who like, this dude has not been good in a long time. He's a specific type of good when he is good that coaches normally dislike. He's a breakaway runner with not like, there's breakaway runners who are consistent in the meantime. And then there's breakaway runners who are like doing nothing in the meantime. And that's kind of where Swift has typically been.
Ken Walker.
Well, Ken Walker got a little bit better at that this year.
He looks like fucking shit right now.
Yeah, true. Maybe it was just the beginning.
I think it's a little bit of it's a little bit of this Seattle's holding him back, but also maybe stop bouncing every run to the outside when the offense
that's his thing. Yeah. So Swift has been, he was bad enough that it looked like he was going to get benched and then defended his job and then has reclaimed it. And now might be getting a little phased out. I saw some Roshan around the goal.
A lot of Roshan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's one of those ones where I'm like, I think I would like to have more Swift than I do. But like, when a Swift type of play goes bad, and here you're talking about new to the team, you know, specifically is like not reliable. Like as an NFL player, he's like not reliable. You put the ball in his hand, say, go get those 2 yards when he's on the first down, and he's not trustworthy in those situations. That is how you get straight up benched. And having a player get like outright benched is very damaging. Now, I did take Zamir White. So, I wish I had applied this thinking.
The story of Zamir White also is that Alexander Mattison got hurt this week, and Zamir White also got hurt this week. It was like you had your chance to get it back down the stretch, and he got hurt too.
That's hilarious. I didn't even realize he got hurt too. God. Yeah. I mean, not hilarious either, but the time.
No need to watch. Yeah. No one should watch Raiders. No one, other than to watch Brock Bowers. There's no need to watch Raiders games because it is absolutely disgusting. But just quickly, Roshan, 10 carries to Swift's 14 carries this week amidst the offensive coordinator change, right? Which I think is a notable.
Lowey bags, by the way. Sorry.
Get ready to learn Amir Abdullah, buddy.
No, Lowey, baby.
I'm pretty sure Abdullah scored this week, I think.
Take cash for the win.
Didn't Lowey fumble on his first? He got a carry earlier this year. Does he still only have the one? I kind of want him.
First carry, fumble. That's the Roto World headline. First carry, first fumble. I'm pretty good.
I kind of want it. I don't know. Does he have more than one carry? If he does, like if he only had one touch and he fumbled it in his rookie season, like that, there's no way that's happened, right?
I took issue with Broderwald had a blurb today that was like Khalil Herbert has not had a touch this year, and I'm like, guys, he has touched the ball. Yeah. It was probably charged to a fumble on Burrow, but it was his fault.
Yeah, I remember getting excited when he was in the game, and I'm like, oh, thank God, maybe he's actually going to get some run here. And then you're like, nope, okay, let's look at my Chase Brown teams, because the Herbert hope has already gone quickly down the drain. Although they stink, the Bengals, so who knows what week 17 will look like.
True. That's a good point.
For a 5-win Bengals team or whatever by week 17. But then
I hope they make the playoffs. I hope they're this year's Bills. They'd be fun in the playoffs.
Dude, they're so fun, even with Zach Taylor holding them back. But Burrow's too good. Burrow Chase T is just
speaking of a tax. Is this tax we need to get rid of Zach Taylor?
I think so. Like we're gonna have to lose money in best ball to maybe make some next year.
Maybe make some next year.
On Bengals tax.
Zach Taylor is bad, but no one's passing anymore, so he's like less bad than he was.
Yeah.
I think I don't want to pay the tax. I want the Bengals to make the playoffs.
Me too.
Dylan Lowey has one game played, one attempt, 0 yards, one football.
God, he is going to get to play now that those guys are hurt. But, man, I wanted to see a full season of one play, one touch, and one fumble.
That would be brutal if that was your whole NFL career.
I would win trivia, right? You go to a sports trivia night, and they're like, name the one player who in an entire season played one snap and had one touch with a fumble. And I would be like, everybody would think I was a genius. You're like, yeah, it's because I draft too many fantasy football teams.
You won't think I'm a genius once you see why I know this guy's name.
Division II white running backs for the Raiders. Like, Jesus. But it was damn near a split snap wise as well for DeAndre Swift and Roshan. So they also played better.
Right.
Offensively, they should have won that game. Bears are going to bear apparently with the blocked field goals at the end, just like the Broncos, but they looked better. Caleb looked better. So better days might be ahead for Roshan and worse days might be ahead for DeAndre Swift.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's one where I'm less like, you're not going to be right about everything. And I'm like, I think he could get himself benched. And he looked like he was going to get himself benched and didn't, but he now might get himself benched again. So I'm like, it was late. The bench, maybe the benching never happens, which is very, very plausible. But I'm just like, yeah, when I see that kind of like, I don't think this guy's that good. And he's going next to guys I think could be good or really good. And so I'm just not going to.
Or we know Warren could be exceptionally good. And James Conner, we know, is just, unless Father Time, it was just so happens to slap him in the face, which, is going to eventually happen. But it sure shit ain't happened yet. The dude's still
a beast. And that's where, again, to the Kamara one, compared to Kamara, Kamara's not going to get benched probably. Like, even if he got bench. He would still be like the receiving back. So that's, you know,
I think it's live. Well, now granted, they just won two in a row, but I think it was live that the Saints are a total house of cards. I think this is the second year in a row. I think I've referenced the house of cards to the Saints on a show that we did, but I mean, the coach,
how's that rebuild of the Saints going in men?
We gave up. It's miserable. Like, it's only
you pulled a Sean Payton.
Yeah, 100%. I'm playing with. I have a Hawaii dynasty in NCAA football. I'm like, this is so much more fun than playing with Jay Kaner and Kendre. I'm like, what are we doing? You know, I'm throwing.
How many years did you make it?
Foster two, Foster Moreau. Like literally, I'm starting Foster Moreau and Jay Kaner and Kendre Miller, and like it's Olave. And like the defense sucks, the offensive line's terrible.
Olave's demanding a trade.
Yeah, I'm like I'm like losing to the computer, and like that's not like the fun of this is to like rebuild the team. And I'm like, you don't get to rebuild it because I have no money, and I'm playing Jake fucking Haner at quarterback. He's not even starting when Derek Carr was out in real life. He didn't even start, and he's my starting quarterback. Man, I was like, what? Like, you know, it takes 40 minutes to play a game or whatever. I'm like, am I really gonna do this? Like, to myself? Like, Jake Haner's not.
You're not simming the games?
Well, no, I want to put up the big stat. Kendre's got to make all pro, buddy.
Oh, I see. It's a Kendre thing. I thought you got to sim the games. I want you to go back and sim the games and see if you can rebuild this team. I think it's a research project.
Yeah, like, that's true.
For us to know how long the Saints are going to be in this.
Yeah, I got to waste my life.
Yeah. So we can know. You're wasting your life writing up Chuba Hubbard.
That's true.
Although that was actually a good use of time.
Yeah, that was the one that I did. I did write a specific article about Kendre this summer. It was early. Okay, in my defense, it was in May. And I was going to bring this up about Kamara. The house of cards with the Saints was part of the reason why I was into Kendre, which seems stupid, right? Because if they collapse, do you really want their running back? But like, dude, they're a mess. We're explaining the fact to my Madden franchise as a Jake Haner, you know, the Foster Moreau, Kendre Miller offense. And it's because they're such a disaster. I was actually one of my good takes was I was pretty certain Dennis Allen would be fired at some point this year or after the season was over, because I just didn't think that after week two I didn't feel so good. I didn't feel so good about that take, but that, you know, the organization just needs a reset. Kamara was a free agent. Then they signed him to a fucking extension.
Signed him. How do they keep finding money?
I don't understand. So we have a shout. His name is Best Ballin in our Discord. He's a Saints fan. That they did free up some like space and stuff with that Kamara extension, you know, but it's typical Saints, right? They're kicking the can down the road, moving money around, and it supposedly from said Saints fan, it's like they want him to retire a Saint, you know, he's a gonna sell tickets guy or whatever. Mm-hmm, and I was like, mm-hmm, but mm-hmm. I was a St. Louis Rams fan. You remember Steven Jackson? That's what they sold us that on Steven Jackson. Like we're going to keep going. We're going to keep winning five games, you know, never get the first overall pick. We're always going to pick eighth. We're going to trade up for Tavon Austin, but we're always going to have Steven Jackson, right? He's going to do a radio show every Sunday. And like, you know, and like, this is so fucking stupid. Like, just tear the shit down, dude. We're awful.
Right.
It's like that. Right. I think that's what they're doing with Kamara. But it's that amongst a lot of other things. Spoiled my Kendre Miller dreams, but I do think that the Saints were like a really, really weird eval, like as an overall team. You could see kind
they're
of
the weird eval team. now,
yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, they have MVS catching touchdowns.
Yeah. What are we supposed to do with that?
Just scored 47.
Yeah. Times. They just had the highest tight end score of the year because a guy played quarterback at tight end. They're a weird eval.
Strange. Jesus Christ. Yeah. And, yeah, I don't want to talk about Taysom anymore. That was painful yesterday. Did you play him in DFS at all?
I didn't. No, I didn't. No.
He was such a good play, too. I'm so
mad. I know he was a good play. We talked about him on the DFS MVP. Davis was touting him, and I was like, you're right. He's a good play. I should play him, and I didn't.
I went on a typical Erik, like a 2-minute ramble about how good of a play Taysom was, Neil and I, on Sunday mornings. And on Sunday morning, and I was like, literally, I was, as I'm saying it, I'm like, God damn, he is a really good player. You know, sometimes you like stumble across it while you're thinking out loud. I'm like, damn, he's leverage on Kamara. He's leverage on Davis Allen. He's leverage on, you know, AJ Barner and Dawson Knox and all this kind of stuff. You know, I like the Jameis stacks. I'm like, this is perfect. Did I play him? No, no, of course not. We got to play Geno. Got to play AJ Barner. You know, sick. Really,
I did. It was, I had Puka, but with Russ. I had Jameis, but not with Puka. I mean, Puka wasn't ultimately the guy, but I was like, Puka was the cover boy of the walkthrough, and I was like, all excited. I had a Cooper Puka stack. Now Davis Allen was on that. Full disclosure, but so it wouldn't have done anything. Ultimately, but
you're Davis, like, Allen chalk.
I moved off of that for another Jameis lineup at the end. So anyway,
Jameis lineups are at least fun.
They were fun. Yeah,
whether you win money or not, it's exciting to watch. A lot more exciting than watching the Seahawks. Although they don't really have boring games, but it's not fun to sweat them because every time you think Seattle's maybe about to get it going, they snap a ball over Geno's head. I never seen a team that snaps the ball over their quarterback's head more than now. Granted, they're
well, the guy retired.
Yeah, but they.
So the new guy's doing it.
They lead the NFL. I believe they've six times. It's happened six times. Oh, somebody on social posted it six times this year. They snapped it over Geno. How the fuck is an NFL team?
He's not Kyler. You know, he's a normal size. He's like
6'3". But yeah, So it was a little more forgivable this week. It was the guy, Connor Williams, retired on Tuesday or whatever it was. But a couple subjects I want to get to because I did ask some questions to our folks in the Discord. I think we've coped and talked about a few hits and talked about some of our misses and process, and hopefully that helps. One question that I think is maybe one of the more fun questions to talk about, like at this point in the year. We're about to head to week 12. Two huge bye weeks, by the way, coming up. Week 12 and no byes in week 13, but week 12 and week 14, six teams on bye, and a lot of, you know, so your Burrow Chase teams feel really good. Chase Brown, better hold on in week 12 because they're out. You got Lamar, you know, Texans, all that kind of stuff in week 14. A lot of byes coming up. But setting all that aside, being this close to the playoffs, if you had to pick a player that you would most want to see, like if you had to have this one player on all of your advancing teams, what player would that be? You can pick Saquon, or you can pick, you know, whatever you want to pick. You want me to go?
I think Nico.
I have a contending wide receiver that is similar. I think Nico is my number one answer, but I actually think Mike Evans is a competitor.
That's a good one.
To Nico.
Yeah.
With Chris Godwin out.
That's a really good one. Yeah.
Baker is fucking awesome. Like, man, I can't believe how good Baker is. And they also do play the Panthers in week 17. Granted, Nico gets the Ravens, so they're both good, but
man, Nico getting the Ravens is nice.
I mean, if you have a Nico Evans team,
wow.
Wheels up, buddy. Like, you wheels sit up. There, you're sweating that one for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, I think those are really, really good. I think Puka is in the mix for me too. Any of these like receivers who just look like they could absolutely smash, you know, 30% target shares down the stretch, that are gonna be hard to advance. Those are pretty good.
Damn, I have four BBM teams with Nico and Mike Evans. This one, I'm kind of surprised it's not. It's only 26 points back, so we're a lot. Oh, okay. It does have Stroud, Nico, so maybe I can jump up.
Nice. Okay.
Tonight, because it's a big. Let me look. We might as well roster bait a little bit at this point in time. There's not a lot. There hasn't been a lot of positives. It's been a lot of tilting Saquon and Alvin Kamara and all that kind of stuff. But this team right here is pretty fun. Stroud, Baker. I mean, Ramondre is not like amazing, but if you're a living, breathing running back, I'm cool with having you on a team. Sharbs, Algier, Mason, Estime, fine. But Jefferson, Nico, Evans, Tank, JSN with Andrews and Janu. I'm cool. I'm
pretty good.
Cool with that.
That's pretty good. God, Rasheed Rice just ruining. I was like, this team looks kind of interesting, and I'm like, why isn't it advancing? It's got Rasheed Rice.
Every time you scroll, you're like, start at the top of the lineup and you work your way down. You're like, ooh, 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 ooh. There's always Rice or Godwin, mm-hmm, or mm-hmm, every single time, man. Every time. Oh, JT. Look at this. JT Kamara. I clearly did not draft that one. Puka. Godwin and Rice. Yep. See? Sick.
Sweet. Achan is another one.
Oh, he's good. What ownership or exposure did you get up to on? I know he was one of your guys.
Let's see. I think high teens. 19% of him. Is that the right thing? I had 31 Achan teams. 31 divided by 150. So 21%. Yeah.
Yeah. She definitely got to be feeling good. But so that's funny. I'm glad you brought him up, because it feels like all the narrative around, we spent a ton of time talking about Saquon and Kamara, and everybody likes to talk about Derrick Henry. Achan, I kind of don't get why. I think it's the trolliness, right? It's easier to troll about Saquon and Derrick Henry, because there's very clear types of people who draft those guys in Kamara, and there's very clear people like us who don't draft them. But Achan, to me, I would like to have him, you know, maybe not quite as much as Saquon, but more. I'd rather have Achan on an advancing team than Derrick Henry.
Personally. Think so.
And
we rank him higher every week. You know, you look at projections and rankings.
To your projection point, I posted about this the last Friday or something about Derrick Henry, just because. So I do exactly what you talked about from a projection standpoint. And especially when we get to the playoffs, certainly when we get to week 17, like the goal and a big part of our draft strategy, why we talk about week 17 is all that matters and all that bullshit, is because what we're really trying to do is put together the best 18 or 20 man team in terms of like our overall projection, right? Like when you pull up DFS projections in week 17, you have, right? Sometimes we'll talk about it salary wise, right? But like Kyren Williams projected for the second most running back points in week 17 last year to only Christian McCaffrey. He was the second highest, right? So Saquon is consistently projecting near the top, but so is Achan. Derrick Henry, actually, even in half PPR, our FanDuel projections at RotoGrinders, I believe, was the RB15 this week in project, like somewhere around, you know, the like RB8 to RB6, like there's a bunch of guys who project within a point or something.
I wrote him up, and then in the rankings, I'm like, God, it's really hard to get him as high as I wanted to, because I like the spot for the Ravens running game. I thought that they'd be able to control that game a little bit more than they did. Obviously they didn't control it. They lost it. I thought that, you know, Henry would be a piece of their game plan there that would make him, you know, like a solid, like running back one, kind of like, you're like locked in. Like, but then I kind of was more like on the running back one, two borderline at the end of the rankings.
You don't realize that either, right? Like, especially if you don't play DFS, if you don't do weekly rankings or anything like that, you don't look at projections. You don't really realize that, because you're like, well, he's the RB2 on the season. Every week you're like, he just keeps scoring fucking touchdowns. Like, you know, you lose sight of the weekly projection aspect of it. And like another guy I wanted to toss in there, who is on somehow on like all of my, I need a big game from this guy, which is fun and not so fun at the same time. Joe Mixon. Joe Mixon never gets lumped into, I know, cause he missed a couple games, but like when Joe Mixon plays, he's been better than Derrick Henry. When Joe Mixon plays.
Mixon's been really good. Mixon's a guy that I wish I had more of, but I did. I took some of him. I was not like, I'm not taking any Mixon. It's funny how, like, you know, some of these guys you're like able to get over the same red flag that with another guy you're like, oh,
I know
he's old and he sucks.
Joe Mixon was he's a little cheaper than all the guys that he's the same as all the guys that I hate, but he's a little bit cheaper. And the Texans go Burr.
It was like Josh. I'd rather have Mixon than Jacobs, but it's like, well, if you're going to say that, then you probably should take some Mixon. I don't have a ton of Mixon. I took 7%. So a little bit below weight, but it was not like a big stand fade for me.
I actually took him. I'm curious what you think about this. I have 12 teams, whatever, in BBM of Mixon, 42% advance rate on Joe Mixon teams. And I have a 17% overall advance rate. So it tells you about who's on my teams. But Mixon was actually like a priority in things like the Eliminator. If you drafted the Marathon or on Drafter or something like that, I actually kind of made him a priority. Not like I didn't take like 25% of him, but I was like, this is a sick format for this. That's why I think I have 5 Eliminator teams left. I think he's on 4 of them because he's just been really good for that format. Even with the missed games, right? You can kind of make up for it early in the season, and you're getting a 5th round running back producing like a 2nd round running back. You don't have the late season type risk as much in something like an Eliminator or a Marathon format like you do in BBM.
Yeah, he's been a good one. I don't know that he'd be like super on my list of guys that I want to have going forward, but he's been nice to have.
Anybody else? What about tight ends? Non-Brock Bowers tight ends.
Non-Brock Bowers edition. I'll this has not been a bag pumping session. But I'll pump the Hunter Henry bags.
Ooh, I like that one.
Yeah, Hunter Henry and Drake May is a stack that I am excited to have just by sheer brute force. Will be advancing some. So I drafted a boatload of Drake May. He looks pretty good to me. I no longer know if I can evaluate Drake May, but I he looks really good to me.
You mean you're not biased at all?
I'm biased. I know I'm deeply biased. Bill Simmons also thinks he looks really good. So, there's a, when you go, he's got to follow all the Pats fans. They all think he's looking good, but
Bill Simmons thinks Patriots quarterback, Young looks good. What a surprise.
I know it's shocking, but, that's one where, I'm happy to get any of those through. That I can. Henry, I think, kind of the top. It's sort of tied with Douglas, I guess, for the top target there. So he's a fun one.
And Henry's much more valuable because he's
you get the tight end
and a little more red zone role than Papa right. Pop looks good. Where would you? So I know you just said you're basically Bill Simmons when it comes to Drake May. He is your Jason Tatum, like Bill Simmons. But if you had to in terms of your excitement levels of how obviously you're going to get Drake, if anybody's getting Drake May teams through, it's going to be you. He's like clearly good. And he's clearly the type of quarterback we want for fantasy, running around, throwing the ball downfield, all that kind of stuff. But he's definitely also being held back by his situation. Like how excited, what is your actual excitement level for like, okay, if I can make it to week 17, or even week 15, 16, because of like, those are so conflicting. You know what I mean? Like our Patriots expectations are so low, but our Drake May in a vacuum expectations are pretty darn high for fantasy.
Yeah. So don't expect objectivity here. as I said, but I'm still pretty excited because it's not just that he looks good to me. He's looking like he's improving, mm-hmm. There's been some really bad plays that he's had. He just threw a pick that sealed a loss last week. So it's not like he's making mistakes. He had a lost fumble last week, a lost fumble the week before, I believe. He's like, the line sucks and is not getting that much from his weapons, but like very willing scrambler, but he also he scrambles at times that it's like, yes, scramble now. And then he's scrambling. The decision-making is pretty good. The throw placement, throwing guys open, just like his command of the offense, it's all like very impressive to me. And I've watched him closely. I have a huge bag of Drake May. I've watched him very closely. And it's like, he's getting better.
Yeah.
He's getting better week after week. He's coming off his, even with, you know, the interception, a lost fumble, he's coming off his best performance of the season by far in EPA. Kevin Cole noted in his write-up of the game that he actually had, if you, because he does a cool thing where he breaks out EPA by categories. So he does like passing EPA minus mistakes. And then he does like sacks and interceptions as its own bucket. And then rushing as its own bucket. May's passing EPA was higher than Stafford's yesterday.
Oh, shit.
Before you add in the mistakes. So what you're getting from the positive. Yeah. Yeah, once you throw in the interception,
I was about to say that feels shocking. I mean, I watched that one. I was like, that feels, but then once you add the mistakes, that makes a ton of
sense. Yeah. Once you add the mistakes, I think he had like 11 EPA and Stafford was in the 20s. So, you know, the mistakes were,
they were high impact flawless mistakes. Yeah, he was flawless yesterday.
Yeah. I'm not saying the mistakes don't matter. They do. But like what you want from a rookie, I think, is to see like increasing, you know, that this guy's actually like out there making plays and creating good things. Cause like the worst thing is like, you're like, could this guy like ever make a play? You know, like, please just make a play. That's like where you're like this, you know, what are you
you're describing? All what's of your quarterbacks? You're describing Daniel Jones and Trevor Lawrence. And I'm trying to think, like, you're just like, please God, something like the,
right.
I'm rooting for Daniel Jones to just fucking scramble so I don't have to watch him overthrow Malik Nabers on another, you know, I don't have to watch him anymore. But, you know, before, you know, it's like you're playing the Panthers. This was supposed to be the game, you know, I'm like, the GIF or whatever, right? Do something, you know, type thing. And you don't have
There's no do something with me. We don't have to do something GIF with him. That's what I'm – and, okay, so then – you know, relative to my optimism in the offseason, I didn't know that Jalen Polk was like a menace. Like, not that he wasn't good, but like just like putting him on the field was like going to destroy plays. I don't know if you know this. Yesterday, I mean, I'm in the weeds on this shit. Yesterday, Drake May on a run play, he called in. This is what I'm talking about. Command of the offense knows that he identified the rush coverage.
He told him who to block.
He told him who to block. So he brings in Polk, tells him to block, doesn't do it well, doesn't get the first down. Okay, now they're going to go for it on fourth down. False start, Jalen Polk. Like, you're costing drives. Like, you're killing me, man. Like, they fine, be a zero.
They almost
be
won
a fucking
game.
Zero on my best ball team. No, they probably should have if Polk doesn't screw up that drive. They were... So anyway, Polk's been a disaster, and there's no, like, no one's booty is like stepping up in a human who can play football and they can put him out there level, but like, he's not elevating. No one's elevating. Douglas isn't elevating. He's fine. So, you
he's
know,
fine.
You can't.
He's Wandale. He's just like Wandale's, like, it's fine that he's out there. He's not hurting you. He's doing some certain things, right, to get open underneath and make a little bit run after the catch, which they need. But he's not like, you're not like, you don't build the ship out of Pop Douglas.
Right. So part of it for me, I was like, we know that very likely this is probably going to happen, you know, that no one's going to be that good. But what if Polk's kind of fun? You know, Polk, he's not fun. You know, it's so that part of it,
it's
I'm less excited to have the May teams advancing than I would be if, like, you know, what if there was like a poor man's Tank Dell somewhere on this roster. There's not, you know,
there's a guy who hasn't gotten his chance yet. Who does all the wide receiver things. Yeah. He also does all the wide receiver things really well that don't have anything to do with catching the ball. The Patriots maybe should consider draft. Do they have jugs machines? In Foxborough, like, none of these dudes can catch. Like, among the other issues you just mentioned with, like, Polk not knowing where to line up or who to block or, you know, how to not false start at wide receiver, which is just anybody that knows, you know, football, like, wide receiver false starts is like little league shit. Like, you cannot false start as a wide receiver. But
and then after he did it, he was like, walk up, feel like, it's like, you're killing me, man. take some accountability.
Yeah, at least be accountable for your mistakes.
Yeah.
But while you're burying Jalen Polk 6 feet under, I was thinking like Javon Baker played, I think, 6 snaps this week or something like that.
Yeah,
I need to go double back. I'm not like pretending he's gonna change anything, but they waived Tyquan. It ain't happening with Polk. KJ Osborne is not the
Bourne,
answer.
Bourne's getting some run.
Yeah, but Bourne looked good. I thought Bourne looked good.
Yeah, he looked pretty good. Week.
But they were going to try to, didn't they say, or maybe this was the broadcast yesterday that was talking about it. They said like, I think they even had a conversation with Bourne where they were like, look, we got to try the young guy. Like, we got to play the young guys, essentially. And then they
were like, Bourne never mind. Back to,
these guys, nope, Kendrick, please. We don't these guys do that. Fucking suck.
These guys suck.
So he came back. Yeah. He caught a touchdown, right, this week?
He caught a touchdown, yeah. But, you know, no one's going to, like – there was, like, an outside chance that if the May bet hit, it would be, like, correlated with another receiver who, like, stepped up. And it was a spot where, like, if you any talent at all, it was a place where that talent could blossom, you know? Very much like the Texans the year before. Like, if you can play, like, we're going to find out. Now, unfortunately, no one can play. So there's where, you know, I don't feel as hopeful like that May's going to have huge games because we haven't really seen the mega ceiling yet. But yeah, I mean, to wrap up a long answer, I'm still pretty excited about having May.
I think so too. I just think the archetype is so strong that, you know, if he can get any run good, you know, a rushing touchdown and maybe somebody actually catches a ball, next thing you know, you got 25 and from a late round quarterback, like, dude, fucking wheels up, man. Like, quarterback scoring, we talked about just scoring overall, right? There's not exactly a whole bunch of big quarterback scoring games, and some of them that are doing it weren't draft, you know, nobody has Jameis Winston or whatever on these teams.
Right.
So
yeah,
I think it's totally fine. I would be excited to Drake May's on one of my, but I didn't draft him very much. And no, this is DraftKings is going much better for me than Underdog.
DraftKings is going better for me too. I did a lot more volume on Underdog though.
Yes. So and not... I tell myself that we love our good friends at Underdog, but I tell myself this every single year. And I'm like, I look at the teams that everybody, that our opponents drafted and stuff on DraftKings. And just like, I'm, it's partially being like a wide receiver lover, but like I'm better at full PPR. I talk about, like, I think that when we have an edge, there being 20 rounds is better for us.
Right.
And I'm like, so PPR is better. I think the market, like there are just like mispriced players on DraftKings, and that's not so much on under, it's a really inefficient market. Like everything is saying play more on DraftKings, you dumb. And then I get to like late August. And I'm like, shit, I haven't drafted very much.
I know.
On DraftKings. Yeah. So stupid.
Yeah. The 555 right now is like the one. It's like my saving grace. I'm not like smashing, but I've got three teams advancing the 5x5, and I'm like, that's fun.
I drafted 20, and I have 7 that could get to maybe 9 in the advancing tonight, pending this game tonight. Yeah, that's nice. The only thing I'm sweating all season. Like I was advancing like 35% BBM teams in like week 3, and it's just cratered. Just every week is like 35 down to 30, down to 26, down to, and I'm at 17 now. So I'm like, I'm done. We're not looking at that anymore. If it works out, it works out. We're gonna sweat these five teams because apparently that's the only place that my season has gone okay. My drafters teams are horrid, truly out. Like I avoided every league winner, so like I'm getting nothing back on
that bet.
I think it's bad to have no Saquon, Derrick Henry, Alvin Kamara. You know, I did not have any of these guys.
Yeah,
on a cumulative scoring site. Just a couple quick more questions. A couple more quick questions before we get out of here. You mentioned before maybe running backs will get pushed up a little bit next year. Do you think that that's like actually going to happen? I'm genuinely curious about the meta after this season with so many wide receiver injuries and underperformance. Do you really like think the dead zone guys will go back to, you know, the guys who are dead zone backs now, you know, the Ken Walkers and the Joe Mixon stuff will go back to like the third round?
Yeah. The fourth at least. Cause we saw that archetype still exist. It was Pacheco, it was ETN. And I avoided both those guys. Now, the Pacheco one could have been pretty bad to avoid. I mean, I think Kareem Hunt shows that, you know, Pacheco would have been a pretty strong pick. But not, I mean, you could, I don't know. Maybe we'll see. You know, maybe he'll show us that he would have been an absolute smash once he returns. But that group, and Henry to an extent, you know, he was more, I'm talking, I guess, round four. You said round three. So who was in round three?
Henry on underdog.
That was kind of it, right?
That was it, I think. It was all.
Pacheco was round four. ETN was round four. So I guess I'm more thinking round four that we would get like a Mixon goes to round four. He's not hanging out the 5-6 turn. He's going to round four. I think like Cook round four, Jacobs round four. I think like that group is going to be just price enforced more.
And so just like, we're also, obviously we don't know who it's going to be, but just thinking about that range, those third round wide receivers probably kind of still right. So the DK Metcalfs, the Mike Evans, the whoever, I'm sure I'm missing some other guys, right? Tank Dell eventually kind of got up there. Like that tier receiver still going to be prioritized. But then we, right after that was when we got to Zay Flowers and Terry McLaurin and George Pickens and Christian Kirk and all that. Maybe that's the range that loses, I think that's out at wide receiver.
I think that range gets pushed down and is more like wide receiver. Like, and not that they're all just going to get shoved down, running backs come up in a clump, but like there's going to be like the running backs are really spaced out through round, like let's say from Derrick Henry to
round six.
Yeah, to round six, like to the Rashad White Mixon,
whoever came off last,
right? There's like really spaced out where you could get James Cook in the fifth, like very regularly. I mean, pretty much all the time he went in the fifth, but like mid late fifth, you get him. I would pair him with Josh Allen sometimes. You know, you could get Jacobs would sometimes fall. I feel like I got Jacobs in the sixth at times, but it was rare. But I mean, he would fall to the mid fifth. Pretty regularly. I think his ADP was more like 4 or 5 turn. ETN didn't tend to fall so much, fortunately, because I like never took him.
Yeah.
Pacheco moved up from the 4 or 5 turn to the 3-4 turn. But anyway, that whole group was like there was a decent amount of guys in that, but there was a pretty big range. I think that range tightens up. I think if you're like youngish starting running back, you're not getting outside the top 55.
Yeah. I don't think that – I think what people are thinking about that reminds me of thinking about thinking. It just said think like 47 times. But people are like, well, it's going to be all, you know, first and second round running backs. And I don't really think that is going to change a ton.
No.
Because there's still not really very many like
– there's not that many guys you would take there. Yeah.
It's just that the next wave, the wide receivers have disappointed, right? Like you said, third, fourth, fifth, sixth round. Overall, the wide receivers have largely disappointed and the running backs have largely been good. So I think you're going to get into some form of tier break. I don't know, right? I don't know who it's going to be, but thinking about this year, you know, at the Tank Dell spot or the DK Metcalf spot or something like that. Once you get past there, it's like that's into the Terry McLaurin. He's like been fine. Right. But like once we reach the fine bucket of wide receiver, I think that fine group got pulled up because of the wide receiver urgency and the market sentiment around wide receivers. I think that fine bucket is going to get moved down in favor of the running backs. And like you said, it's going to, so we're just going to reach the ETN or whatever range. Everybody's just going to start, all those guys, running backs are going to slide up a little bit. Where does it land? I don't know. But I think it's that tier. You know, third, fourth,
yeah,
sixth, seventh round running backs that's going to start to all move up instead of the wide receivers.
And I think that's probably likely to happen in part because some of those running backs will be rookies that we'll all be excited about.
Yeah. We're going to
get a rookie class, right?
We're going to get a new influx. We'll see what like a Chase Brown looks like, right? Heading into the offseason. We're going to get a couple of those guys. Najee is not signed for Pittsburgh next year, right? So like who knows what's going on there? Who knows what's going on with, you know, there's a lot of uncertainty around these backfields. So although the Panthers did did re-sign Chuba. I was just going to say, you know,
oh, they did. Yeah.
We'll see with Brooks, but we're going to run it back with that. Anytime you have the worst roster in the NFL and you can just devote all your assets to the running back position, give Miles Sanders the bag and then let him lose his job to Chuba. And then draft Jonathan Brooks in the second round and then re-sign Chuba for an extension after mortgaging the future for Bryce Young. You got to do it. They are really funny. Just the only other thing, I'm having flashbacks to all these games yesterday. Josh Jacobs, did you see he breaks a tackle into the open field? I do kind of think like Josh Jacobs would be fun to play on the team with him because I think he's kind of a bad motherfucker. Like I think he is like the football player you would not want to play against, but also like we hate him analytically, right? He breaks into the open field and there's the safety is, you know, coming down from 25 yards deep to come make a tackle. He's in the open field. He points at the safety and goes like this. He gave him the Matrix, dude. He pointed at he did this, and the safety came down and tried to hit him, and he just like shrugged him off, and he's like, you know, puff. He's doing, you know what, you know, the guys do this
on the sideline or whatever.
I was like, oh, this dude's fucking awesome. I can't believe I've like been such a Josh Jacobs hater all this time. He literally is running in.
How many yards did he get out of that move?
It was like a 3 yard extra
point. Yeah, 3 yards.
He should have tried to make him miss.
Yeah, he should have tried to make him miss.
But he was like, no, fuck that. Like, come here. I'm going to run you over, little fella. Like, it was awesome. That's this season. I'm trying to get joy out of running backs I didn't draft. Saquon, you know, doing crazy hurdles backwards, and Josh Jacobs doing that. But let's go ahead and get
that
out of here.
Many running backs.
No,
when we think it like that, you know,
it just feels so bad. It really just feels bad. This environment, if you're drafters like me, the actual practicality, you can be fine. If you avoided Saquon, even if you avoided Derrick Henry, it's the issue is wide receiver. You needed to make up for it somewhere, and we don't have the wide receiver juice to help really make up for it. You could find right, dude. If you didn't have Derrick Henry, but you have Chuba Hubbard, who gives a fuck? Like you don't. If you have James Conner, you know, yeah, you have Alvin Kamara, you have Chase Brown, you're feeling great, dude. You can have awesome zero running back rooms. The problem is zero running back wide receiver rooms.
That's the problem. That's the problem. And so I don't know. I mean, like, I guess the real question is, like, do we draft a lot of these wide receivers high again? And I think we do. Because, like Saquon Mixon, this is just by points per game, PPR. Saquon Mixon, Henry, Kamara, right there, like, you know, top two rounds. Are we going mixing it back in the second round? Like, I don't know. That feels a little rich.
No.
Walker probably, but I don't love it. Gibbs, definitely. Bijan, definitely. Kyren, definitely. Assuming
Gibbs is even like a goofy one, but Gibbs is even like a goofy one where like, I know he's going to be there. He's awesome. If I have him on a team, I'm not upset about it, but it's also still like, I'm still drafting a split backfield. Got like David Montgomery is awesome. Like David Montgomery's really good at football. So like you need a David Montgomery. And you know, Gibbs is going to be the best, you know, they're the best committee backs that you could ever possibly have, but it's still like if David Montgomery got hurt, is Jahmyr Gibbs better than Saquon? Would you rather have Jahmyr Gibbs than Saquon if David Montgomery got hurt?
Yeah.
So that's why
he catches passes. Like, he catches passes. He's just an explosive. Yeah.
The offense is just the offense. The offense is better. The
offense is better.
The Lions are 7-for-7 touchdowns yesterday.
I mean,
that's ridiculous.
Yeah. Jared Goff just threw for 400 yards and 4 touchdowns, and the backfield had 3 touchdowns.
Yes. And they combined for 200 rushing. Then they have 200 rushing yards. They had 600 something yards of offense. And they benched the starters in the fourth quarter. Right. They're playing Hendon Hooker
and Craig Reynolds. Yeah. And Craig Reynolds had a good game.
Our Lions, it could not be. The one thing the fantasy community got right was us going to the Our Lions mantra. And they are everything that is right with football. Nowadays, like they put the backups in and they still play football. right? Mm-hmm. It's not the boomer shit. It's like, no, Hendon Hooker's out. We need Hendon Hooker to get, like, let's reward these dudes, right? Like, why the fuck are we running it three times and punting? Like, let Hendon Hooker throw it. They went for it on fourth down. They did a QB sneak on fourth down with the back up 52-7 or whatever. Like, that's amazing. That's awesome. Like, that's what it should be.
Yeah, I love it. Dan Campbell, he's the best.
Absolute legend. We'll see. I'm interested to see what happens when Ben Johnson is gone. I imagine every good offensive coordinator mind is going to want that job. Like the OC, you know, it's just going to be that's the springboard. You know, that's the new Belichick's OC or DC.
Yeah, that's a good point. He can actually attract talent. Also, he is an offensive mind. He came up under Sean Payton. Right. Everyone thinks he's defensive because he's
the mentality guy.
And he drinks because he's massive
a
and he's
gallon of piped coffee,
one coffee and he's like, let's go for it. But no, he's actually an offensive mind.
He's a tight end.
He's a tight end. Yeah, yeah. By the way, he got Brock Wright a touchdown yesterday. He loves Brock Wright more than anybody.
I was waiting. I almost, this is no joke, I almost played Shane Zylstra. You remember the three touchdown Zylstra game? I was like, you know what? My actual takes in DFS have not been working out really well. Let's just play this Lions bullshit tight end narrative. Let's try Shane Zylstra. And he caught the first tight end pass.
When I look at the receivers next year, I think there's a lot of guys that we're going to be excited about.
Yeah.
So I don't think
it hasn't hit, but it's not because these guys aren't exciting when they're on the field.
Brian Thomas is going real high next year.
Smash.
You know, Malik Nabers, give that guy a quarterback. Like, my God. Ladd McConkey in year two is, you know, already becoming the number one in year one.
JSN is mid
breakout. JSN's legit now. I mean, Jameson Williams is probably going to go top four rounds. Jaden Reed. Zay Flowers looks fine enough to go kind of where he did. Well, maybe a little bit later. Maybe he's more like 4 or 5 term. I don't think he escapes the fifth round.
He's still really good.
Yeah, he's still good.
You're not mad if Zay Flowers is on your team.
Garrett Wilson will go reasonably high, you know, even though who knows what'll happen with Adams and all that stuff. But
let's save the Jets combo for a different
time. Let's save the Jets combo. Marvin Harrison is disappointing as he's been for the price. He's wide receiver 25 in PPR points. And he's gonna, you know, the Cardinals are looking pretty good on offense. Like, I think he'll be.
We don't ditch that profile.
Yeah,
after he'll probably go in the year.
Late second round. Mm-hmm. He'll probably go like 5 picks after where we went this year.
where does Nico go? So Chase, how would you order
real
Chase,
high
Jefferson real high. Nico is Nico ahead of either Chase or Jefferson?
No,
is
he third? I don't think so. Just because of like. The talent certainty and the kind of has been there.
Yeah, but he's about to go scorched earth.
He's about to go scorched earth. Yeah, it's true. I guess I could see him.
JJ's been awesome, but he just hasn't, you know, Chase has been unreal. But like JJ hasn't really like he had any big games because their defense is too damn good. So they, you know, he's never like going nuts in the fourth quarter.
He's also probably going to McCarthy, who's gonna be more conservative most likely and less one probably.
Side note, hilarious. Are we going to have the same conversation of quarterback concerns for Justin Jefferson? Yeah. He's probably going to have 1,500 yards again.
I know this year. I know. But I think you're right. I think it probably goes Chase and then maybe Nico too, depending on how he closes out.
Is Diggs under contract for next year? I know he'll be coming off an ACL tear, but still.
I'm not sure if they re-signed him. I don't think so. I thought he was on a one-year deal, but it was like kind of clear they would renew.
CeeDee or Nico?
I think Nico could pass CeeDee, given just how bad this. Yeah, and just given how bad this year has been for. Well, Dak will be back and everything, but
yeah, but like, you know, we attach to what happened the year before.
Right.
And if Nico Nico goes ham here this final month and CeeDee just looks like CeeDee has looked all season. He's going to have Cooper Rush or, God forbid, Trey Lance at quarterback.
And Dak was bad this year, too. Mm-hmm. So
they were a disaster. That's one thing I feel bad at 500 on the remember we talked quite a bit about two offenses that we expect to be elite. but the players aren't elite. Other like on the team, turns out Josh Allen is too good. Like a Josh Allen offense is just going to be good. It doesn't matter what the rest of the plane looks like. Dak Prescott, not quite good enough to overcome all of these issues that Dallas had, because that offense is awful.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, I mean, where does Amon go? Probably pretty similar still to where
first round. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nico's ahead of Amon-Ra, but he's still ahead of all those other guys. After
ahead of CD, I think.
CD? What would you take Amon-Ra over CD?
I think the market will ask me to, and I will oblige.
Yeah.
That's where I'm at. I don't think I'm going to make a stink about it.
I didn't take much Amon-Ra this year because he quite often went ahead of JJ, and I thought that was wrong. The Lions are too good.
I should have just
taken the really, really good wide receiver on the really, really good offense and like not made a fuss about it, like you said.
Yeah. If the Giants get any kind of quarterback, where does Neighbors go?
He's the London of this year.
The London range?
Oh, man, yeah, that 1-2 turn or something like that.
I'll hammer him there.
Yeah. Would you take AJ Brown? If Neighbors gets a real quarterback, would you take AJ Brown or Malik Neighbors?
Like, what do you mean real? Like, how's real? How real?
I'm trying to think of an example here. I don't have a good
trade for Cousins.
Yeah, Kirk Cousins level. Call that, you know.
Yeah, give me Neighbors over
average to above average NFL pocket passing quarterback. You know, not Justin Fields bullshit. A Kirk Cousins type for Malik Neighbors.
I'm taking Neighbors over AJ Brown. People, yeah. I'm not stepping there. I would take Neighbors over CD. I think at that
point. Ooh, that's a fun one.
With Cousins, fun one.
Yeah, I mean Cousins unlocks everybody.
Yeah,
Darnell Mooney's gonna make the goddamn Pro Bowl. Cousins, what the fuck would Malik Neighbors do?
Yeah,
Jesus.
Darius Slayton's about to smash.
Yes, I could use it, which is nothing quite like a zero RB drafter being like, please God, Darius Slayton and Cedric Tillman. Save my team.
Hey, Tillman might save you. He's been great.
I know. I got a little sprinkle. I thought it was going to be Parker Washington coming to the rescue, but has Peterson
Pickens been fired also yet? Another? Pickens is another. I mean, there's a lot of. Looking at the wide receivers, I think we're going to find. I mean, I didn't mention Debo. With Ayuk out for the whole. I mean, you know, who knows what they're going to get from him next year?
Cup.
Tyreek.
Metcalf, Tyreek, Waddle. Yeah. Where does Waddle go? Like, now where do you take him? Where does Waddle get drafted? Do we find it? Does the market finally give up? Yeah.
Sixth round.
Because we keep
putting. That's kind of where we put guys that we're like, we haven't like fully given up on you, but like, you've really let us down
and JMO here. Range, right? They're the
Godwin after last year. You really let us down here, man. Yeah.
That's a good call. Okay. Another one. I like this game. But this is like this is our version of you know, the joke that goes around that the guys will literally sit around naming random athletes. Yeah.
We're naming future ADPs.
I'm having
a great time.
This is like what I'll sit around after, you know, 8 beers with like all the family, and we're naming all the, you know, these 1980s St. Louis Cardinals players, and that's what we're doing here.
What about the Bears guys?
Yeah, I was just going to say DJ Moore. I was just going to say DJ Moore because we gifted him the 2-3 turn, and he certainly has not paid that off, but I don't think it's a DJ Moore issue.
So Keenan Allen is going to be gone, right? I think he's on his final year.
I fucking hope so. I never want to see Keenan Allen again.
By the way, Diggs is a free agent. I looked that up. So Keenan is also a free agent after the year.
Nico's
so
definitely going in the top three then if Diggs is gone.
Yeah, Nico's going top three if Diggs is gone for sure. All right, so let's assume that it really shouldn't matter, but for some reason it appears to. So Keenan's elsewhere. You got Rome and DJ Moore kind of forming a tandem, unsure about which guy is going to lead the way.
Are we? Are we really? Like,
I mean, the targets have been there for Rome recently.
I know, but they came out. What I thought was really cool this week with whatever, what's his nuts, the new offensive coordinator.
What's his nuts?
Yeah, I don't know. Sorry. No, I don't know what his name is.
I don't know if I've heard that before. 10 targets for Rome last week.
Yeah, but it was like the first, like five of the first six passes were like the script, right? You know, the scripted plays. Everybody knows you come out, you script the first X amount of the plays. It was like all DJ Moore. They just came out and they said, okay, enough is enough. Enough of this Keenan, you know, not getting open bullshit. We're feeding DJ Moore. And I still believe that he's like awesome, quite frankly. Maybe I'll be wrong about that, but I kind of think he's still, it's more 1A, 1B, right? This is not a Nico Tank situation.
I think he goes like fourth round.
DJ Moore?
DJ Moore goes fourth.
So then Rome probably right after him.
Rome goes right after him, yeah.
Yeah.
Rome's like 4-5. Kind of in that zone where you're like, I don't know what I'm getting. Could be fifth. It's possible he's like in the Jaden Reed fifth round zone.
Right. Jaden Reed feels like not a terrible kind of ADP comp.
Yeah. For him,
right. It's like, is he really the one? He's talented. But like he was okay as a rookie, right. You know, Jaden Reed was a little better than okay, but you know, you get,
and then more maybe in the, like the Zay Flowers-y kind of early fourth.
Yeah.
Round.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Terry, Zay Flowers.
That yeah. Kind of
thing.
Yeah.
What about fresh off of just a monster game last night, free agent T Higgins, where does T need to go to be, you know, a high pick, and what happens, you know, what's the range of outcomes for T. Higgins?
Now, best ball is played year to year, but I'm still hoping he goes to New England to be with Drake May. That's where I want. Now, it doesn't affect my back. It doesn't even help me that much. I'm not playing as much
dynasty. It doesn't help you at all. What do you mean it doesn't help me that much?
Well, I'm invested in dynasty a little bit. I've got some guys. But not that much. Not enough to care. But I still do care deeply. I want T. Higgins to go to New England and be the clear wide receiver one there. Who I think, by the way, would be a pretty good fit. Drake May likes to put it up high and have his guys come up and grab it. T. Higgins would love it there. that's one option for him. You know, joking aside, not just New England, but like a spot where he's the clear one. And I think there he's probably like, what are you pulling out? Oh, yes, do it. Arrest this guy for jaywalking because I skipped taking a long stroll down Patriots Way, baby. Still, a lot of websites have been degraded over the years. Not this one. GreatFitPatriots.com still hits.
Everybody go check out GreatFitPatriots.com. And for the audio listeners, I plugged in T. Higgins to see what kind of fit T. Higgins would. Just play around with it because you'll get some good laughs. But the response on is T. Higgins a, you know, fit with the Patriots is arrest this guy for jaywalking now because I see him taking a long stroll down Patriots Way.
See, if Stephon Diggs is a good fit coming off an ACL tear.
Let's see.
Wow, great call. Hadn't thought of that one. We deserve to see him in the Patriots system. That's a very accurate take. GreatFitPatriots.com. Well done.
That is so funny. Also, press inquiries got me at the bottom here. Really, really got me. But yeah, I couldn't help it when you said T is a great fit on the Patriots. I had to go look.
It's a great fit.
It was nailed. The quote was too good.
So that, like, I'm sure there's other situations where he'd be the clear number one.
Carolina, Washington.
Yeah. Well, but Perry's there.
Yeah, but
he'd split.
Yeah, it's a split. Would you rather? Yeah, the Patriots would be better than Washington, but Daniels would be nice. Denver.
Denver. Yeah,
it's like, I mean, Bo Nix is pretty good.
He looks pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for a relative expectations.
Relatively,
not amazing, but he's better than I think most people. Would have.
And I was drafting some of them, but he's definitely he's been a pleasant surprise. Don't go to like the Colts or something. That's
no, please no.
If he goes to like something like the Colts or, you know, just one of the like a bad,
they shouldn't though. They got, you know, unless they, what are they going to do? Banish
AD Mitchell.
But like the Steelers, you could see him going to like the Steelers or something.
Oh, yeah.
So if he goes to the Steelers, I think we're talking about him in like the sixth, seventh round.
Who goes sixth first, round? Pickens or T, if they're both on the Steelers?
Pickens.
Ooh, that's rough for T.
Pickens has shown he can be the number one. He can hit, you know, bigger plays. Yeah, I think. Yeah.
Got that dog in him.
But I think T could go as high as like the third round.
Yeah. Maybe. Yeah. I do think I would have, before we did this exercise, I think I would have said like, oh man, if T really lands, you know, on New England with Drake May or something, like we're talking second round or something, but it really is a lot better. The wider, it, like I said, it feels so bad because they're not scoring that many points and they've all missed time. Right. And some of the best hits have gotten hurt. So it feels really bad, but the wide receiver landscape is in great shape, like incredible shape heading into next year. So in terms of the kind of question about the running back landscape.
Yeah, we didn't even mention Devontae Smith.
Yeah. Like we're talking about putting Jalen Waddle in the sixth, seventh round. We didn't even mention Devontae Smith. Like Stephon Diggs is an afterthought free agent, you know, whatever, like no one cares. You know, we didn't mention Rashee Rice, who is awkward, but going to be probably suspended coming off of an
ACL. He'll be suspended, but now we're more confident in his role and his ability. Yeah, although they're coming off the ACL tear. God, that's going to be a tough
mess.
Yeah.
But yeah, but like we're not lacking for the wide receiver firepower. So I think if you're thinking about overreacting to how this season has played out, I think when you lay it out, it's kind of like you said, like you go to a weekly every single week and you go look at projections and like it tells a different story for someone like a Derrick Henry than what the season feels like happening to you if you didn't draft him or if you did. And that's how I feel about the wide receiver stuff. Like it feels so fucking bad. Like you look at your teams and they feel really, really bad with your wide receiver rooms. So you might think like, I got to change how I draft heading into next year. And I don't think the wide receiver landscape is in a spot where we should panic about this year. I think it's just a little bit fluky. I mean, too high safety, you know, all the running game stuff aside, the wide receiver firepower is not really an issue across the, you know, the first six, seven rounds of drafts.
Yeah. And, you know, I do think that part of the answer to like the league shifting away from the pass a little bit and passing games becoming less efficient, I think one of the answers is just quarterbacks are willing to take more risk. And you know, maybe offensive coordinators are willing to take a little bit more risk than they used to. Like the league did not used to be that comfortable passing, and then it became more comfortable because passing got like less risky. Mm-hmm. You know, you could get higher yards per attempt and lower interception rates. And like they had all these easy buttons, you could figure stuff out.
PI pass interference is the easiest way to move the ball down the field, and these guys, it's like damn near impossible to play one-on-one pass defense down the field against these mutants without committing
people. Right. Yeah. So I think that there's like, if you get more quarterbacks who are just like willing to kind of chuck it a little bit deep, you know, and like, it's been a rough ride here for Caleb Williams, but he's willing to do that, you know, you know, put him in a little bit more of a modern, you know, give him an actual OC instead of Shane Waldron. It might start to
he
be
did
more
look a little better this week. But did you watch? Well, I'm sure you did. But Drake, did you watch the Bears Patriots game? A side note, I played Caleb Williams in DFS that week, and that was I think that's the worst quarterback performance I've seen. And like, buddy, I watched the Daniel Jones games. I watched Zach Wilson. Like, that was maybe the worst quarterback performance I've ever seen in an NFL game. Certainly from someone with talent.
Right.
Tim Boyle or something was worse. But like from someone who's expected to be an NFL starter, I think that's the worst game, especially against a bad defense that I've
ever seen. I'm glad to hear you've wiped all of Zach Wilson's career from your mind.
Maybe Zach Wilson is on an untouchable pedestal in this argument, but Caleb came in and was trying to compete.
Yeah, he was trying to compete with the Zach Wilson.
That was so bad. Oh my God.
No, and I think, I do have hope that there will be kind of a, like, I don't think we're going back to where we were, where you're like just able to like kind of carve up these defenses to the defensive have answers to that. But I think there might be something that's like a little bit closer to where we were before this, where you had like, you know, more like your Andrew Lux and those types of quarterbacks. They were throwing more picks. They're making some more mistakes than like the 2018 Goff. I don't know. We're not getting like the 2018. I mean, we're kind of getting 2018 Goff this year with Goff, but it's in a much more run heavy. That was a balanced team in terms of like the play calling. The Lions are much, much more built around the run. So yeah, I don't know. Well, I still do have some optimism for passing in the NFL. I know that's like puts me on an island at this point, but
it's also, everything is cyclical. Like it's a chess match, right? It's just like any other game, like peer-to-peer game competition where you're playing against other people. Like this, like it, I think sometimes we treat it like it's a little bit like robotic and like, oh, like the, you know, we get concerned when things don't go according to plan or things don't maybe seem logical. Like, how did the other team's best player not have a good game? Like the matchup was so good. And it's like that, all that's fine. But like, you have to realize the defense is game planning too. It's like, you know, you don't think every time somebody plays against the Minnesota Vikings, they're aware that Justin Jefferson plays for the Minnesota Vikings. It's like, you know, we get so confused sometimes when a lot of this stuff happens. It just so happens right now to kind of be on the opposite side, right? Offenses are going to punch back, right? Like they're going to figure things out how to beat this. Like it's still the rules and everything are all still very much set up for the offense. The running stuff may be a big counter to it. And then guess what? When now all these offenses are scoring, dinking and dunking and running for, if Saquon's running for 6 yards a carry over 300, over 300 carries in a season, you don't think the other team's going to think about that, right? Like it's a constant chess match back and forth, and it's never always going to stay one way. So I'm trying to keep that in mind too, right? To myself, it's like, don't overreact to this, because everybody's always, it's a punch counter punch. It's a boxing match.
Yeah, I think I do think some of it is attitude. Like we're seeing the Bengals still pass a bunch, and now you know they probably
effectively too.
Effectively,
like, you don't think they're getting two high safeties? You don't think they're double teaming Jamar Chase? Like, yeah, the one touchdown, like it was they're like triple teaming him or whatever out of the backfield. He ran a route out of the backfield and they damn near triple teamed him. So like they're seeing all this stuff too. The Bengals,
yeah,
but they're throwing it effectively.
They're still throwing it, yeah, and some of it, I think, is like just the variance of kind of where the good offensive lines are versus the good quarterbacks. Like the Rams have not been able to protect Stafford well for years, really since the Super Bowl run. That they're, you know, their pass protection has been quite poor. I wrote up in the walkthrough last week my optimism for the Rams against a Patriots team that was not did not have an effective pass rush, and then you know. Much to my delight, they like did not double team. I don't know that the numbers I look at are going to match this exactly, but I was reading reviews of the game, recaps of the game, and they were saying that they didn't double team Cup or Puka once.
Jesus.
They didn't shadow either guy with Gonzalez. They just had Gonzalez do his thing, and they let the Rams move those guys. I mean, it's very like 2018 style, where they're like, you do what you want on off, we're going to be, and this is where we'll find, when you want to find us, we'll be here, and you do whatever you want to do. And they're having Puka run out of the backfield. His first big catch, he lined up, he kind of ran through the offensive line. Mm-hmm. That's like one of the things that they've been experimenting with this year. Went for like 38 yards right off the bat. So I don't know. I mean, I think the good offensive coordinators are going to keep finding answers for these defenses. It's going to be like,
I don't think Sean McVay is studying this shit.
Yeah.
Like,
we'll be okay. We'll be okay.
He's not a moron. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like the guy, but will like, figure something out. He may retire.
Stafford, if you give him a better offensive line, you know, then I think that the Rams would be like way more. If the Rams had better offensive line and the receivers were staying healthy, you know, if the Chiefs didn't have their best receiver get hurt, you know, if the Bills had not,
he's also their best counterpunch and
had receivers.
Their receiver who is specifically their best counterpunch to how teams are playing defense against them.
To this.
Right.
Yeah.
He's not, no offense to like Tyreek or whatever, but he's not that, like, I mean, Tyreek's amazing, but like Tyreek can do some funky things, but you're never really like throwing a whole bunch of hitches in between the linebackers to Tyreek Hill and then saying, you know, go do work. You really want him in space. Whereas Rasheed is just like, just sit down somewhere in the like, just be on the same page with Mahomes. He's going to get it to you. Go do your, you know, go do your thing after the catch.
What if Trevor Lawrence had an offensive line that played a little bit better and a coach that we had some respect for? You know, that could with Brian Thomas, they're not going to challenge deep. You know, I don't know. I think that we're going to find there's outs to fun teams changing the global conversation around the passing game. I think maybe it'll take another year or two, but I think we get there.
I also think you mentioned the one big thing that never gets talked about in like the whole too high safety bullshit is offensive line play. It's the worst offensive line play currently. And probably maybe it's not the worst offensive line play, but it's the best pass rushing. And so the offensive line play is kind of lagging behind, right? And pass protection schemes are behind, right? Like watch Brian Flores put on a clinic. Go watch Brian Flores put on a clinic every week with all of his crazy pressure packages. Go watch TJ Watt rush the passer, you know, and Nick Bosa rush the passer and Micah Parsons. It's like they're not blockable by one person. You know, it's like you can't just bait, you know, five man protections don't work. You know, against some team, again, the New England, Atlanta, I think you and I might be able to hold up against the Falcons pass rush. Like, Jesus Christ, do they even have defensive linemen? Also, they traded for Matthew Judon, and these guys can't get any pressure. But anyway, the pass rush is a lot of, like, if you can protect good quarterbacks with good receivers, they're going to get open no matter how many safeties you put deep. They're just going to get open. You can't cover for that long. The problem is, you don't have that long, right? These guys, you know, are getting back to the quarterback so quick. And then even when they do, sometimes you got to manipulate the pocket, right? Last night, if anybody watched, Burrow made a really good throw to Gesicki. I think it was over the middle, one of their tight ends. They all look the same. And, you know, 15-yard, 20-yard play or whatever, but he didn't have time and he had to step up in the pocket and evade some rush. And he had Jamar again. Jamar could have had another for a 60-yard touchdown and Jamar's, you know, throwing a fit or whatever, but Burrow can't see him because he had to redirect
because
of the pass rush. If they can solve some of that, more than like some of the schematics of the you know, passing concepts, it's probably how can they get more time for
I think that's a big part of it. Yeah. And that's where when I was excited about the Rams, you know, as I said, it was partly because the Patriots pass rush is not scary. And because when you look at what are the Rams doing when they have time and where are Matthew Stafford's deep middle throws happening, it's when he's kept clean.
Yep.
That's, you know, and you know, some of them we're seeing kept clean and time, you know, additional time to throw, not quick throws. So you give him a little more time. If a guy knows he's going to be on pressure, so this is the other part of it too, is like, what are you planning for to happen to you, right? Like you're going in there. What are you going in expecting? Are you going in expecting that you're going to be able to have enough time to execute some of these concepts? Or are you going, you know, and I don't know, maybe we're wrong. Maybe like, you know, there used to be 7-step drops, Mike Martz type stuff. And it's, you know, it's more of like a quick passing. Maybe the Baker Mayfield type of like quick pass stuff is where we're headed now.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, Baker Mayfield has been very, very effective this year. So there are probably going to be a few different answers to how to beat this stuff, which frankly is like what we need. The ecosystem of the NFL got a little like, you know, what was it like the there was only one strain of banana and it got wiped out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Monoculture. Yep. A bit of an issue with,
it's what people complain about with the NBA. That's what people complain about with the NBA. NBA is going through a little bit of this too, where defense has started to counterpunch against, well, everybody understands the threes and layups, right? And kick out threes and particularly corner, like everyone understands, it's just a math, right? It's pretty basic math. Everybody understands the optimal way to play the game based on the rules. And NFL teams and offenses started to figure that out. Now defenses started, right? So it's this constant going back and forth. And this year, last year in the NBA as well, it was like defenses started figuring out more. So it started to become a little bit actually more like the mid-range game and stuff they're talking about is like making a little bit more of a comeback. Like you're even seeing the James Hardens of the world who were like James, I never watched for like 10 years, James Harden shoot a jump shot, you know, between the rim and the 3-point line. It was like, there was no reason to ever do it, but defenses are counterpunching and, you know, taking away the rim. And then, you know, there he's able to get to the mid range. So it's becoming a more efficient shot. even though mathematically it's not really right. It's kind of like that
for right because they're letting you have it a little bit more.
It's the best shot sometimes now, and it basically never used to be the best shot. It was all layups, dunks, and threes.
Yeah, that's interesting. But I think my one hope I have is that we'll see different answers to the question, which will then, you know, create more issues for the defenses because they're, you know, there's been kind of a dominant strain here in the NFL in terms of what was sort of sharp offensive design. And maybe we'll get a few different styles. We used to have that, you know, we used to have like the North Turner style was pretty different than than the Shanahan system.
So. I think it piggybacks on something we talked about. Was it last time or over the summer? I can't remember. But where we kind of talked about coaching and offensive coordinators and stuff like that. And I think I don't know how good we'll be. This is the thing I always struggle with is like, I know it's important, but I don't know if I can predict it. And that's really an important distinction. I think it in the short term, while offenses are figuring out like how to react to maybe some of this stuff that's going on and trying to figure out the right way to attack these defenses, is that these offensive coordinators are going to be really, really important in terms of where we put our trust in these fantasy offenses. Like, again, that, you know, I know that they just fired their offensive coordinator, but trusting in the Bears despite all of this talent, is Caleb Williams actually bad? Was he put in a bad situation? Did he get the yips because he was put in a bad situation? Like, I have no idea. I don't know how to effectively judge the Bears because I know that they were put in a bad, you know, situation. They also have bad offensive line. So they're suffering from the pass rush issues and a moron calling plays who hands the ball off to fucking offensive linemen, you know, at the goal line. But like that, having that versus having this, like, right, we can make fun of Zach Taylor, but the Bengals are out here slinging the fucking thing and throwing it to Jamar 12 times a game. And how many targets did T and Jamar have total? Like 28 last night. It's like, they're coming out, they're giving the ball to Chase Brown, Jamar Chase, and T Higgins, and they're throwing it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like that difference between those two is so big and so important.
And I don't even think Taylor's good. Taylor's just like competent.
Yeah. He's just kind of handing it over to Burrow, really.
Yeah. Right?
He's just like, I'm just putting the faith in, I got four horses. let's ride those four horses, which is like kind of commendable in and of itself. He's realizing, like, you know, he doesn't need to solve world hunger. He's got the greatest, one of the best trios, you know,
right,
in the entire NFL. But there's other, right there, McVay. Like, I feel overwhelmingly confident I can trust in Sean McVay.
It's McVay, Shanahan.
Even Shanahan's struggling a little bit right now, quite frankly. Like, it's not struggling on Shanahan.
He's getting production out of Juwan Johnson and George Kittle's had a hell of a year.
I think Juwan Jennings might just be a fucking
baller. I said Juwan Johnson. Yeah. Juwan Jennings is a baller. Yeah. He's a baller, but he's with a baller within that system, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I think he doesn't make any, but the
Juwan Jennings career arc makes less sense to me than the Davante Adams career arc. I'll be totally honest with you. I don't get it. Like, I tried. People were, again, as Juwan was going nuts again yesterday. So it's a funny bit within the Spike Week community because during the big board season, or at the beginning, anyway, after Curtis Samuel had signed, I think, with the Bills, I was like kind of into Curtis Samuel. I think he's like a pretty good football, well, at least I did. Thought he was like a totally fine football player, right? They got no digs, blah, blah, blah. You know, all the perks of Curtis Samuel. And Rob was basically like, he's worse than Juwan Jennings. I'd rather have Juwan Jennings straight up. And I was like, you know that, like, Juwan Jennings is like the wide receiver four on the 49ers. And so we went, like, had this like running bit about Juwan Jennings versus Curtis Samuel, and Curtis Samuel is so useless and Juwan Jennings is the second coming of fucking,
he's really good.
And I'm just like getting buried on a continual basis by this stupid fucking like random argument about two useless, what we thought were useless players, and Juwan Jennings just immediately turned into this stud. But he is at 27, in the fourth year, 27-year-old breakout for Juwan Jennings.
Well, I'm also tilted because I saw that chaos in a Shanahan system meant, you know, chaos plus there is Shanahan here is something we should target, which is why you got to load up on Ricky Pearsall. I do actually have Juwan Jennings on one of my better best ball teams, but you know, on DK with the 20 rounds. But yeah, Ricky Pearsall, directionally accurate with there.
Yeah, that's the story of my season in so many ways, is directionally accurate. It's the playoffs for college football best ball on Underdog. This past week was just the first round of the playoffs, and it's gone pretty well for me. But I'm looking through all my teams, and dude, if you think NFL is nuts and this NFL season is nuts, everybody should try college next year, because like, you want to talk about dudes getting benched or dudes just coming out of nowhere, like, it's crazy. Like, you wanted to, like, you're like always interested in, right, like Iowa, they suck on offense, but their running back's always going to be like productive, and they were all literally all in the last round or whatever. Caleb Johnson, who is going to be like a second round pick in the NFL draft next year, he's a fucking, like, if Ashton Jeanty didn't exist, everybody would be like, who the hell is this Caleb Johnson dude? Because he is unbelievable. Naturally, I got who's now like the fourth stringer. He's been passed by every Iowa running back with a pulse, has passed the guy that I drafted, right? And it was like LSU, good offense to invest in. Let's take their running back. Nope, same thing. Some random freshman comes out of nowhere and takes the job. I'm like, I have all the backs on the offenses that, like, these guys are going to be all Americans. And I drafted the guy who's now like the fourth stringer. That's what I feel about like the Juwan Jennings situation. It's like, love the 49ers. Didn't draft any of the best fucking 49er to draft, I guess, other than Kittle.
But I thought I drafted a college best ball team, and it's not coming up on my.
Well, did it make the playoffs?
Oh, is it the playoffs? No.
Yeah.
I guess it didn't. Yeah. Yeah. I guess it didn't. I was curious who I drafted because I don't know college football that well, but I'm like, I wonder. Let's see.
It's fun. It's super flex. They do force you to have tight ends, and there's like two good tight ends in all of college
football. Finish sixth.
Hey, that's not bad.
Finish sixth. Didn't have any of the guys you just mentioned. I did have Trevor Etienne. A little Etienne tie-in. That was fun.
He sucks, by the way.
Damn it.
It's tough to be a Georgia running back and not really do anything, but Etienne sure putting that to the test.
What happened to Eugene Wilson?
Hurt.
Okay.
That's the thing, dude. Injuries, college is bananas. Like, if people thought like Anthony Richardson getting benched and stuff, like, these dude, kids leave the program during the season. They go in the portal.
That's crazy.
Like, in the middle of the season. So not even just like benchings and injuries and all that. Sometimes the kids just leave the team. like imagine that. Imagine that in the NFL landscape. You know what I mean? you got a fourth round. And sometimes they've been like scoring fantasy points and like helping you, right? And you're like, my fifth round pick just decided to go sell insurance in the middle of the season. It's like, what the fuck, man? It's crazy. But
let's
go ahead and get out of here. I think I said about an hour ago. Well, yeah.
It was my fault. I broke this back into a conversation about an hour ago.
We said, well, if you get some bros in the room and you just start naming random athletes, yeah, it's going to go, yeah, that conversation is going to go on for a while. So you guys got to, instead of hanging out with your friends doing it, you got to listen to Pat and I do it. But we'll probably come back. I don't know. Pat and I haven't talked about it yet, but sometime before the best ball playoffs come around. I know Pat will probably be doing playoff best ball content. We'll be doing playoff best ball content here at Spike Week. So be on the lookout for all of that stuff. Like, subscribe, all that fun jazz. And if you made it this far, I just want to give the one quick reminder, 40% off of Spike Week with your legendary upside subscription. Huge, huge, huge for playoff best ball. I think it's a cheat code to use all of the tools. Go ahead.
Yeah, playoff best ball is a big focus of what we're doing at Legendary Upside as well. So if you're looking to play up best ball, the signing up, getting the 40% off Spike Week, it's the way to go.
Totally agree. We'll be back sometime soon with another episode here, and